Friday night in Fitchburg, and it is in September, and it's time for football, but it's not at Crocker Field. Instead, we are here at Elliott Field on the campus of Fitchburg State University as the Falcons get ready to take on the Bulldogs of Dean here on FATV, and of course, also on the FATV app, as well as FATV.org. Welcome to the newly redone surface here at Elliott Field. It is a beautiful night for any activity, really, but especially college football. It's a new look field here at Elliott Field, and it's a new look Fitchburg State University team as well. I'm John Gugerty, joined, of course, by Dan Bullock. And Dan, for the Fitchburg State University team, there's really nowhere to go but up, is there?
Obviously, last season was a bit of a challenge for the Falcons. First year for head coach Scott Sperone. It was a two-year process to get themselves on the field. The pandemic, of course, laid the largest of wrenches into things. Things didn't go as well as they would have liked. Again, 0-10, their closest game, a 38-35 loss to Worcester State in the third game of the season. And last year, they only brought back a hand. Last season, coming in, they only had a handful of players who really had collegiate experience. This year, they have 28 players returning from last season, a lot more experience. And the players that are coming back, they're a year wiser and a little bit bigger and a little bit stronger and a little bit more prepared for the season at hand.
Size was definitely a challenge for the Falcons last season. Head coach Scott Sperone did mention that was one of the things they were working on. They're going to try to emphasize the running game again. 7 out of the 10 linemen on the roster are returning from 2021. So as you said, Dan, a little bit more experience, a little bit more seasoning, maybe just a little more time in the weight room for those guys. We take a look at the other side now, and the Bulldogs of Dean, similar story. They did pick up a couple of victories last season, 2-8 overall. Worth noting, both of their victories were against teams that otherwise went winless. That's one of the many statistics I will drop today that Dan researched. Thank you, Dan. But for Dean, it's a 2-8 team from last season that lost by far their two best players.
Indeed, Errol Braille was a dynamic receiver for the Bulldogs last season. And in the season opener against Fitchburg State down in Franklin, he scored 5 touchdowns on receptions and a 6th on the ground. David Curry was a standout quarterback who was also a dynamic threat on the ground. He was 5th in the ECFC in rushing yards. Very good for a quarterback. But Curry did not return. Brio graduated. And those are two huge losses for this Dean side, who have a new head coach in Andre Murphy.
Murphy, as you said, in his first season at Dean, previously was an assistant at Columbia, spent the last 4 years as their defensive backs coach. He's also coached at Holy Cross, Florida Atlantic, and Mass Maritime. And that's only scratching the surface when it comes to his interesting story. We'll hear a little bit more about Coach Murphy as the game moves along. While we have a moment here as the teams are heading out to midfield for the coin toss, we want to give thanks to our underwriters. FATV's remote productions are underwritten by Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance, Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise. Thank you so much to them. If you or your business are interested in being an underwriter for Fitchburg Access Television, well, we're not proud. We're a little proud. They're standards, but they're low. Go to FATV.org or give us a call, 978-343-0834. See the Falcons out there coming out onto the field wearing the green and white. It's a good look, Dan. You know, green top, monochromatic towel, pant. It's a joke that Dan gets because I'm wearing green with a yellow tie.
A solid, sharp look for the green and gold. They're numbering in the high 50s coming into this season. And of course, that's a little bit of a challenge, is the fact that the depth isn't as big as they would like, but team chemistry was a bit of an issue last season. Coach Sperone talked about it with me last week. He mentioned there was division, some cliques, some discord in the locker room. And you know, that's been excised a bit. And you've got a lot of players who are buying in and trying to win together as a team. He quoted Bill Parcells, who once said that losers assemble in small groups and complain, winners assemble as a team and find a way to win.
Captains heading to midfield for both sides. For the Falcons, it'll be Frank Sims, Matty Aire, Luke Noyes, looks like Logan Perez. And of course, Dean is obstructed at the moment, but we'll get them in a second.
Kishon Bullard,
Tyson Poole,
Quintus Reed, and Matt Blake are
there
the four captains.
Go. Dean in the white tops with red helmets. If they were the Red Raiders, we'd call that the brick helmets, but we'll just go with red today.
We'll save that one for next week.
Exactly. Looks like Dean has won and deferred, so the Falcon offense will get the ball to start the season. It's always a special, unique feeling atmosphere here. Friday night football at Elliott Field. I like it. We should do more of these.
It's a pretty special layout. They only do it every so often. It's not an every season thing, but every couple of seasons we get one of these games, and it's a tremendous atmosphere on a Friday night under the lights. We love covering those games at Crocker Field with the Fitchburg High Red Raiders, and of course it's always special when you get to come out here to Elliott Field, especially with the brand new turf, the brand new track, the brand new everything really here at Elliott Field.
The first kickoff on the new surface here at Elliott Field is moments away, but for right now we will step aside for the playing of our national anthem. It's Fitchburg State University football right here on FATV.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time we ask that you please stand, if you are able, as we honor the United States of America with the playing of our national anthem.
Fitchburg State University football here on FATV. I'm John Gugerty, joined, of course, by Dan Bolak. And Dan, we were talking a little bit about Andre Murphy, the head coach for the Bulldogs of Dean. Certainly, it would be an understatement to say he's had a bit of an unusual career getting him to this point.
Indeed. You know, he started his college life at Dean College back in the mid-2000s, back when it was a junior college, a two-year institution. He got his associates from Dean. Then he went on to Bridgewater State, was all MASCAC and all New England as a defensive back and linebacker, helped lead the Bears to a MASCAC championship, did not graduate from Bridgewater State. He moved on into the Army for 4 years, and then went and got his bachelor's degree from Salem State, and then went on to become an assistant at Mass Maritime. He's also had coaching stops at Holy Cross and Florida Atlantic, but also he's got three MASCAC teams in his experiences. It's quite a lot.
It's been quite the career path. It'll be Nikolai Luch getting ready to kick off. The freshman for Dean set back deep for the Falcons are Kayshawn McCurdy and Elijah Zaire McKnight. And here with the play-by-play to kick us off is Dan Bolak.
Thank you very much. We've been waiting 10 long months for this one. The Falcons have been waiting a bit longer for a victory. And the Bulldogs, they've been waiting just as long. Luch with the kick, and we're underway. Kicks it to the far side, and it will be McCurdy who will take it in at the 15-yard line, make his way to the near side of the field, 25 and 30, trying to dance on the tightrope, stays in bounds, gets his way past midfield. A tremendous return for Keyshawn McCurdy to open the season.
McCurdy spent 5, 6, 7 seconds just running absolutely laterally around the 20-yard line, just waiting for that block. Finally, when he was right at the sideline, He got that one big block. We'll take a look at it again here. Didn't see who threw it initially. I think it comes from, yes, it does. It comes right there from Elijah Zaire McKnight, the other returner, threw a great block. That allowed McCurdy to turn the corner, take it all the way into Bulldog territory.
47 yards from goal are the Falcons on their first drive of the season. Zaire McKnight in motion. Logan Wilson is the quarterback on first down. He takes it up the middle, but wrapped up by two Bulldogs and stopping him for just a gain of 1 yard. Zion Edison and Nicholas Grimaldi were the two Bulldogs getting in on the stop.
And immediately, Dan, here on the first play from scrimmage, you see a little bit of evolution in the Falcon playbook. How often did they go shotgun on first down, first play of the game last season? Felt like it was very rare, but they're back in it now.
Yep, they're working out of the pistol. That's something Coach Barone says they've added to the playbook for this season, to add a little more. And on the option, it's Frank Sims taking it to the far side, wrestled out of bounds, ultimately getting to the flank, but not getting much yardage downfield. It's only going to be a couple yards gain, and brings up about a third and about eight.
Dan, we were talking before the game about how Coach Scott Sperone has a history of running in a triple option type of offense. If, you know, if the Falcons are going to do something like that, I'm not going to complain about it.
They've got a couple of yards gained thus far. Dean was not very good at stopping the run last year. 237 yards a game they conceded. Zaire McKnight in motion goes behind the fullback as Wilson drops a pass. Looks left side downfield, way too strong. He was looking for Matty Aguirre, but just put way too much oomph on that pass.
Pretty well covered by Keen Meeks. Interesting play call there. You've got the right-handed quarterback in Wilson. And he rolls out to his left, so he's got to kind of turn his shoulder, almost throw against his body. Might have contributed to the overthrow there. Now TJ Farr will come in to presumably kick it away, but you never know with these Falcons.
Farr is the backup quarterback, and the Falcons ran 9 fake punts last season. Quintus Reed is back to return if TJ Farr releases it from his foot.
Didn't I say something like, if it's fourth and medium at midfield, you better watch out?
He will get the punt away. It spirals in the air in not the greatest of direction and fashion. And it's not the punt that the sophomore from Princeton was looking for. They're gonna spot it just short of the 30-yard line.
So about a, what's that, a 15-yard kick, 10-yard punt?
Yep, and they actually add a couple more steps to it. The 33 is what they're going to give. And so pretty good field position for the Bulldogs to start on their first drive of the campaign. 13:34 to go in the first quarter. And we expect it's going to be Darren McDermott, the sophomore from Danvers, who will be the quarterback for the Bulldogs.
It is indeed McDermott. He's got Bullard along with Holden Wilson in the backfield.
He looks to throw on first down, going for the very deep pass. It is hauled in, but out of bounds. He's looking for Quintus Reed on the near side. Just going for deep distance on first down. And Dean, from the looks of their two deep and the looks of how they're constructing their team, I think this is going to be a pass-heavy side.
Certainly seems that way. We've got McDermott, the sophomore out of Danvers.
Obviously with a different coach last year, 274 and a half yards a game through the air is what Dean did. Second down, it is a run out to the left side that never really went much of anywhere. Cameron Topkin is able to wrap up the runner for the Bulldogs there in Holden Wilson.
Wilson took that handoff and was immediately hit by Cam Manette. He was able to bounce off of Manette, but that first contact really spun him off in a negative direction, wound up losing about 4 yards on the play. It'll be third and 14 now for the Bulldogs.
But they will continue out of the shotgun with four receivers, two to the left, two to the right. McDermott with a bit of time, but now pressured by Perez, has to get a pass off, and that's intercepted! Cameron Topkin! The pressure from the Falcons' defense forces McDermott into an error, and the Falcons with tremendous field position.
Cameron Topkin, the freshman from Norwich, playing his first game as a Falcon, is Johnny on the spot here. This is a terribly thrown ball, Dan. McDermott is going backwards. He's throwing off of his back foot. He leads his receiver to the point where I couldn't even tell who the intended receiver was. Topkin had to go full extension just to get his hands on it. Another big play for the Falcons, this time on defense, and once again, the offense starts with the ball on Dean's side of the field.
On first down, it's a run up the middle. Sims runs into the contact of the D-line, gets a few yards. 2 yards is officially given there on first down. McDermott with just 15 career pass attempts coming into this season. Went for the deep ball on the first one, and on the second one, a tremendously not up to snuff underthrow.
Mentioned that Dean lost both their best quarterback and best receiver. Going to be interesting to see how the Bulldog offense does.
Zaire McKnight on the end around. He was in motion. He gets to the near side and gets a couple more yards. He'll get to the 31-yard line. But Dean has been doing fairly solid thus far.
Dez Diaz with the hit. We'll take a look at it again. See, McKnight comes in motion there. Gets a good hole at first, but then Diaz dives in, and he's able to make the hit. Gain of just a couple. Falcon offense hasn't been able to put much together with their two possessions in Dean's territory so far. They face another third down here.
He's seven to go for the green and gold. Went three and out on the first drive. Very well in four down territory as Wilson rolls right side, throws. That's going to be caught by Aguirre. He's going to be tackled inside the 30-yard line. It's not going to be enough for a first down, but he makes the reception around the 27.
A little bit of positive yardage for the Falcons. You mentioned, Dan, it's definitely four down territory. So they weren't committed to needing to go past the sticks here. Good protection for Wilson. He's able to get the pass away. It's a little bit high, but really it's just great coverage by Dre Kidd. He's able to hit Aguirre as soon as he makes the catch. Stop him before he picks up any yards after said catch. Brings up a fourth and three for Fitchburg.
Although Dean did lose a lot of players on offense that were impact players, they brought a lot of good defensive players back. And that's definitely helping them. It's Zaire McKnight. No, it's actually someone else. Is he going? Maybe it was Zaire McKnight, and I'm just misreading numbers. But he gets the 20-yard line, and it's a first down.
First down of the season for Fitchburg. It wasn't exactly easy, although that is the man's name. Elijah Zaire McKnight came in motion once again, but this time they didn't pitch it to him. They handed it off to him. Seen a lot of creativity out of the Falcons thus far. A lot of different looks, even if you know you send a guy in motion, that doesn't necessarily mean the same thing every play. This time they came from the flanker position, and he just winds up taking it right behind that left guard, picks up a first down.
So it'll be first and 10. If you're not seeing the down and distance, the scoreboard in the booth here is malfunctioning, just so you know. But 20 yards from goal are the Falcons. Into the red zone they go. Aguirre in motion goes to the right. It's going to be Sims up the middle. No, actually, what's happened here? It's Dean's got the football is what's happened here.
Logan Wilson kept it on the option and then made the decision to pitch, and then it went all south from there.
The thing with the triple option is you get a little bit of that misdirection. Sometimes we don't quite see where the ball goes. I know I didn't quite see where the ball went. And where it went was nowhere good for the green and gold.
So Wilson took the snap, tried to hand off to Sims. I think we'll take another look at it here. And you see right there, he makes the decision to pitch it back. And then right there, he was trying to get the pitch back to Aguirre. Pitch was a little bit off target. Aguirre wasn't in a great position to receive it. Ball hits the turf, Dean winds up on top.
So Bulldogs on first down. It's Keyshawn Bullard who makes the run. He's still going. He makes his way to around the 40-yard line. There is a penalty flag on the play. So we'll see how much of this will count.
It's a great run by Bullard, but that flag was thrown by the referee behind the line. I think most of it's coming back.
Holding offense, number 56. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
Gage Maxfield, the freshman O-lineman from Stewartstraft, Virginia, gets his name in the score sheet on debut and not the way he would have liked. Breaks up a pretty good run there by Bullard. So backed up to the 14-yard line goes Dean. Looks like the marker originally on the 21, so we'll say it is first and 17.
Down on the field, they have it second down, but that's incorrect. It is still first down.
A You're going to move the placement of the ball from one hash to the other, it so seems. Or now they'll move it back. Put it right in the middle.
Yeah, that works.
A nice balanced location for the football. 9:20 to go, first quarter, no score. Dean, second possession of the contest. Dermott will keep it. Now pitch it out, left side. Finding a bit of space, making his way there, Moses Mooney.
Moses Mooney, the ball carrier, no flag on the play.
And another penalty flag has come in.
This one came pretty late in the play. So I think Dean's going to get credit for at least most of this. But we'll see.
In the end, they've committed the same infraction. It's another hold.
Holding. Offense. Number four. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
Jordan Mason, the junior tight end from Stockbridge, Georgia. Another one of the more dynamic players that Dean brings back on offense, guilty of the hold. Now, we're not approaching 6 holds in 8 plays like we had that one time against Framingham last season. But right now,
it's trending poorly. It's not good. It's 2 in a row. It's the 3rd first down in a row for Dean.
Hold on, first and 17.
So about 10 of those yards count, and they all got taken away on the hold. So it was almost as if the play didn't really happen.
Pretty much.
So we'll try 1st and 17 again. Bullard gets the handoff. Found some space on the right side. He's got a lot of space to work with as he makes his way to the 30-yard line. Tackled there, but we'll get to 2nd down now.
Dean's had a lot of success, Dan, running to the right side on this drive. Obviously, the first time they tried it, it got called back due to a hold, but this time the play is clean. And you see Bullard takes that handoff, and there's just nobody there. Right tackle does a great job keeping the edge open for him. He's able to break into open territory, picks up about 15 yards.
Bullard last year, 185 yards on the ground, 182 yards in receiving yards, the senior from Miami Gardens, Florida. Definitely going to be counted on to be the lead running back, I believe, for this Bulldog team this year. Dermott rolling left side, and that's where his progress stops. Calvin Guillaume is able to take him down.
McDermott looked like he wanted to take off and run with it. We've already seen Dean run the option. McDermott might be a little bit more mobile back there, but Guillaume was able to stay with him. See right there, McDermott still looking downfield, finally makes the commitment to run. He runs right into the arms of Guillaume, who was able to shed the block of Jordan Mason. It brings up 3rd down for the Bulldogs.
Guillaume is a sophomore from Cambridge, went to Cambridge, Ringed Ladin. I believe Giancarlo Morazzo Henry, another player who played for those Falcons. Also played rugby there at CRNL. On 3rd down, Bullard trying to, looking at the middle, then he goes to the left side, and he's got a lot of space to run. Wrapped up by Polanco, just past midfield, it'll be a 1st down for Dean.
Keyshawn Bullard, fastest man on the field by a long shot. Very explosive presence in this Bulldog backfield. Take another look at this one.
He's looking to go up the middle, then he cuts the left because he sees the space there, and he just turns on the jets, gets big yardage.
Yeah, I think that was a designed run to the right, and Bullard just saw that there was nothing there. Great awareness by him.
He's doing well in getting to the flanks. Stumbles and trips a little bit as he tries to cross the 45-yard line.
Yeah, I think that's our first blown tire on the new surface here at Elliott Field.
Had to happen sooner or later. Perez will get the tackle for the green and gold.
It does look really good.
Yeah, I'm really happy with that. The brand new playing surface, 2 yards gained for Bullard on 1st down. 2nd down, 8 to go from the 44-yard line. Bullard again is going to try to make his way up the middle. But any hole that was there collapses into a sea of nothingness, and it's 2 yards more gained by Bullard. Brings up a 3rd and 6.
I believe it was Sebastian Burmester along with the aforementioned Mr. Morazzo Henry who made the hit. Logan Perez in as well. It'll be 3rd down and about 6 now for the Bulldogs.
Bullard has been doing pretty well in the running game there for Dean. He's up to 42 yards of running on 4 carries. McDermott looking right side. That one going to be hauled in. Not enough for a 1st down if I'm looking at the correct person. Moses Mooney makes the catch. One of those cases where I'm looking through my binoculars and I don't see where the ball's gone.
Mooney had one man to beat, and it looked for a second like he was going to be able to. But it's only about a gain of three. Of course, now just on the edges of the maroon zone, Bulldogs are going to keep the offense on the field here.
They'll go for it on fourth down. McDermott quickly running backwards, trying to find any space to get a throw off. And that pass is hauled in by Ryan McDonald on the sideline. That's a turnover on downs.
That play was doomed from the start, Dan. McDonald, I think McDonald saw that before the snap, Luke Noyes was going to come from his left side, the defensive right side. Noyes was trying to time the snap count. He got it just wrong. But I think he actually spooked McDermott, because as soon as McDermott took the snap, he was immediately backing up, rolling to his right. He wasn't actually under a lot of pressure. He just kind of rolled right and chucked it.
But he was going backwards immediately, just trying to find any amount of space and time. And the throw was nowhere in the vicinity of a Bulldog. And so a lot of misdirection and the like, and a swing out to Zaire McKnight on the far side. And he's going to have a first down back into Bulldog territory.
Fitchburg State's first snap of the season in their own territory, and the offense decides, no, we don't like this. Let's get across midfield.
You can see on that, they had Aguirre in motion and fakes it sort of as if it's going to be a direct snap to Aguirre. Wilson pulls it in, throws it to the right, finds Zaire McKnight, and already we're already seeing what Elijah Zaire McKnight can do since he only got to play a few games last season.
Falcons sorely missed him from the offense last year. Looks like a lot of the offensive game plan is to get the ball in his hands.
Frank Sims driving up the middle on first down, and Frank Sims the fourth gets 4 yards.
It's a good run for number four. How about that?
Mm-hmm. You know, and Frank Sims, he was wearing 44 in seasons past, but number four has opened up for him. And when you've got that number synergy going, you've got to go for it.
Oh, absolutely.
4:30 to go, first quarter, no score. Second down and six to go. Zaire McKnight in motion, he goes to left side, but it'll be Sims holding with both hands and driving forward. Getting a few more yards, I think that's another 4 yards.
That is in fact a gain of four for number four, how about that? Listen, if you hand the ball off to the guy and he gets exactly 4 yards every single time, he's literally the best running back in the history of football. So it's impressive if he can do it.
I'm going on the field.
Late timeout on the field. Matt Blake for Dean had to be helped off real quick.
Two to go in the first quarter of play. Have a quick look at the stats and where we are right now. Fitchburg on 26 offensive yards, 32 offensive yards. The live stats refresh just as you start saying them, of course.
Of course.
And Dean with 34, so pretty evenly balanced. Each team has a turnover. Third and less than 6 feet to go for a first down for Fitchburg State.
Falcon offense has been moving the ball pretty well on their last couple of possessions. Obviously, the last one was shortchanged by that failed option.
Sims isn't going to get 4 yards this time, but I think he's going to get more than 4 feet.
I don't know.
It's going to be pretty close, actually.
He came out of the pile right at the 35-yard line, but they're spotting it back at the 36. It's going to be very close. I think we're going to get a measurement here.
It's going to come down to the spot of the football, and if it's going to be fourth down, it's not going to be by very much.
Time out for a measurement.
We're going to have our first measurement of the season. 3:28 to go in the first.
All right, Dan, first measurement of the year. Do you want to go first, or do you want me to go first? I have an opinion already if you want to wait.
I think he's going to be short by about 6 inches.
Yeah, that's about exactly what I was going to say, actually. Looks like the chains are just beyond the 36, and the ball's just a little short. But we'll see. That is not a first down.
It's a little bit
more than 6 inches. That's about, what, 18 inches, I think?
It is the length of the football, I think it is.
Okay, so what's a football? Just 10 inches, maybe?
It's one of those things that you'd think that we would know off the top of our heads. How long is a football normally?
You'd think. But, you know, it's a quarterback sneak here, right? It's fourth and less than a foot. You line up under center, you hike the ball, you plow forward, you get the first down. This is not fancy, is it?
That seems like the way to go.
Dean seems very ready for that possibility.
They'll put a man in motion anyway. And after faking the option for a moment, then Logan Wilson drives forward, gets 2 yards, and gets the first down.
Oh.
I want to preface the following statement by saying I acknowledge that it worked. I fully acknowledge that it worked. I hated that play call. It worked. It turned out to be good.
Yeah,
faking the toss when everyone thinks you're going to QB sneak, faking you're not doing that and then doing it. I acknowledge again that it worked, and I am the one talking and not the one coaching football.
It gets the first down, a fresh set of downs, 29 yards from goal. There are 200 seconds to go in the frame, and we have a penalty.
I think they're going to get Ayire for a false start.
False start, offense, number 23, 5 yards, repeat first down.
Got it exactly right.
Yeah, basically, Wilson did that, you know, quarterback hut-hut thing where he fakes the snap call, and on one of those fake snaps, Ayire leaned forward. He might have argued that he was getting set, kind of like he's doing now, but it was a pretty deliberate motion, so that's a false start.
Quick throw out, near side, Zahir Gomez, he's got the catch, shakes off a tackle, making his way, shakes off another tackle, continues to pinball around as he makes his way to the 30.
That's a great effort by Zahir Gomez. They try to set up the screen for him, have him behind the blocking of Elijah Zahir McKnight. Gomez had three guys on him at once, and he was able to pull each of them off, get about 8 yards out of it, make it a much more manageable second down and 7.
First career reception for the freshman from Whittier, California. So second and 7. Half the yards gained for the first down after the false start. Now Wilson pump fakes, now tries to go up the middle. But of course the hole collapses a little quickly. Does still get a couple of yards out of it, brings down a third and manageable.
I think that was some pretty good improvisation there by Logan Wilson. I would bet that the designed play there was another quick pass, this time out to the far right, but the Bulldog line all jumped up. They were ready for it. That was either a designed pump fake and then QB draw, or just a great improvisation by Wilson to realize that the ball would not get through. There was no way that pass was getting out. So he just kept it himself and tried to make something out of it.
Does get a few yards out of it. Puts the ball on the 28-yard line. Line to gain is the 24. Again out of the pistol with Zahir McKnight in motion. And Wilson dropping back, throws left side, finds Zahir McKnight, has to shake off the tackle. Now he's got a bit of space, still moving forward. I think he's going to have the first down, and he's past the 25-yard line. And the penalty comes in.
A late hit after the play. That's going to be half the distance to the goal and a definite Falcon first down. Easy McKnight is not having an easy go of it so far. There were guys, once again, all over him, blowing up that screen pass, but he was able to dance out of tackles and pick up the first down. And then he got whacked afterward.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, on the defense, number 6. 15 yards, or half the distance to the goal from the dead ball spot. Automatic first down.
Drake Kidd,
that is number 6, first unsportsmanlike conduct of the game.
Yep, so Drake Kidd, the junior from Manassas, Virginia, 78 tackles last season and 5 interceptions, one of the most dynamic players that Dean has on offer, comes up with not one of his brightest decisions at the end of that.
And you saw Coach Murphy was not too happy with it either.
It's going to be pretty close to a first down, but after that, it's definitely a first down. And now 12 yards from goal as we approach a minute to go in the first quarter. Falcons looking for their first touchdown of the season. Out of the pistol, it will be Sims trying to find his way to the right side. But it's great read there by, I believe it's Joe Penton, a sophomore from Bealeton, Virginia. My goodness, they have quite a recruiting pipeline with Virginia, don't they?
They must. But it is indeed Joe Penton who makes the hit here. Just drags him down from behind, almost a horse collar, to be honest. But he wrapped his arm around sufficiently. About 30 seconds to go here in the first quarter. Fitchburg State only put up 6 points in their game against Dean last year. They're looking to match that total here.
Clock is frozen at a minute because I made a programming error.
Ah.
Let's leave it there. So it's second down and time to go and 10.4 on the clock.
Timeout, Fitchburg State.
As the play
their
clock was running down.
Of the half.
And so timeout called by the Falcons with 10.4 on the clock.
Dan, was it last year we were talking about how you have this uncanny knack for almost calling Fitchburg touchdowns?
Mm-hmm.
And then they just kind of fall into my lap?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to have the end of this drive no matter how it goes?
I would like to have a go.
Okay. That's cool.
Because wasn't it a game last year where I joked when there was 4 or 5 touchdowns in the first quarter, I joked, if it was me calling it, it would have been 0-0.
That sounds familiar.
Well, we're 10 seconds away from it being 0-0, unless something nice happens on this next play.
It'll be fine. I tell you, Dan, we really have seen just how much EZ McKnight means to this offense. You know, they really missed him last year, and just these last two drives, he has been a key part of this Falcon attack.
It'll be second down and about 12. And they'll pitch out to McKnight. He's thinking about throwing it. He is going to throw it. And it's through the hands of one of the Bulldogs there in Nicholas Grimaldi and incomplete.
I think he wanted to find Dylan Cosner. Cosner wasn't open, so he turned back to his right and was looking for the quarterback, Wilson. Pass was a little bit overthrown for him and very nearly picked. We'll take a look at it again.
Interesting gadget play there. Zaire McKnight tries to make the throw, but again, just the intended receiver not open, just trying to improvise. Nearly disastrous. So 5.6 on the clock. It'll bring up third down and long.
It's about third and 4. You wonder exactly how much leg Linnea DeKeel has, whether the Falcons would go for it on fourth or bring out the field goal unit. Depends how much they gain here, I assume.
Wilson with a little bit of a high snap, and now an end around as it comes to Zaire McKnight, who tries to drive to the right side. He's got some room. He's making his way to the end zone. Touchdown, Falcons! The explosiveness of Elijah Zaire McKnight puts the Falcons on the board on the last play of the first quarter.
Dan, I thought it was Friday night, but when the ball's in his hands, it is easy like Sunday morning for the Fitchburg State offense. They have come up with all sorts of ways to get the ball into the hands of Elijah Zaire McKnight. Is it too soon to say give the ball to number 3 and watch him do something?
Tremendous running, some tremendous movement. Extra point by Linnea DeKeel is good. 1 quarter time at Elliott Field, and the Falcons lead 7-0.
We mentioned they scored 6 points in their first game, in their game last year against Dean. Well, in a quarter of the time, they have beaten that record 7-0 for Fitchburg State. They take the lead. This team has a long way to go, folks. I am not here to say that the Falcons are going to go 10-0 and win the Mass CAC and be the greatest team in the history
of
college
football. That's the end of the first
quarter. Or anything like that. They're probably bad. Let me just preface this statement again. They're probably bad. They look so much better than last year. Danny, would it not be fair to say that the Falcons look so much better on both sides of the ball?
They do.
Than they do last
they
year.
Have far more experience. They got Zaire McKnight back, but also I've been loving the play calling direction. We've been seeing a lot of interesting moves out there. The playbook last year, mostly out of the flex bone, it was, I think as you mentioned, the playbook seemed a little more basic than you would expect, and I think a lot of defenses were able to dial into that, but they've worked a lot in the offseason at expanding the playbook, expanding their options, and making it so that you could do just about, you don't really know what to expect on any given play. First game of the season, some of the film that you may have had from last season that you may have been able to watch on demand at FATB.org. may not be applicable anymore.
You got to throw that stuff out the window, Dan. This is a Falcon team that is doing things, that is trying things on offense. It is a pleasure to see from the commentary booth. Lene DeKeel will kick it away for Fitchburg State. Quintus Reed and Keyshawn Bullard back to receive for the Bulldogs. Falcons, it should be noted, are a little bit tricksy. They might be, it's worth noting that they're just kind of lining up there, and they are indeed going for the onside kick. Rolls through the hands of the Bulldog. It's a loose ball. Manny Ayere falls on it. Fitchburg fall.
The Falcons were 4-for-8 on onside kicks last season. That's always been a strategy for them. They pull it out on their first kickoff of the season, and they make it work.
Ryan Tiggs was ready for it. He wasn't caught off guard. It was rolling right through him. It just went right through his legs, and then Matty Ayere was able to fall on top of it. We'll take another look at it here. The keel just runs up to it, tries to catch him by surprise, and again, Tiggs was ready. Tiggs was there, but it went right through his legs, and then Matty Ayere jumped on it. So once again, Dan, once again, this is the fourth time Fitchburg State has had the ball. They've run one play in their own territory.
Is that optimism flowing through the air here at Elliott Field?
It could well be. TJ Farr, the quarterback now for the Falcons, hands off to Sims running to the right. Hit after a gain of a couple. It'll be second down and about 8 for Fitchburg State.
I was talking with Coach Sperone last week. He mentioned that the starting quarterback job had not been fully settled by that point, and it would not be surprising to see both Logan Wilson and TJ Farr get snaps under center. Farr was on the team last year, obviously. He was the backup punter. He did not get any snaps under center. He did run a couple of fake punts, though.
Looks like they might be going just quarter by quarter as we start period number 2. TJ Farr is the signal caller. He will go under center once again. Easy in motion and a timeout called by the Falcons. Their second of
timeout,
the half
Pittsburgh
already.
State. Their second charge timeout of the half.
Still 14 minutes, 18 seconds to play here in the second quarter. Fitchburg State only has one timeout for the remainder of the first half.
While we have a moment, I think we can try to do a little bit of a scoreboard update. A couple of games going on right now involving MASCAC teams. Dean is the only team in the ECFC in action tonight. Westfield State is hosting Nichols College, and that has no score through one quarter of play. And in a battle of Worcester, Worcester State is playing WPI, and the engineers of WPI hold a 14-7 lead with a minute and a half to go in the first quarter.
Worcester State came in 7th in the MASCAC preseason poll. Fitchburg State probably fairly came in last, but you know.
They were a unanimous pick for last place. They got the minimum 8 points.
It is not a controversial nor offensive statement to say that the Fitchburg State University Falcons were bad at football in 2021.
And a lot of times you do see coaches generally will sort of go with the general trend from the previous season.
Second down and 8 now for the Falcons. They're at the 44-yard line of the Bulldogs. McKnight in motion, and we'll get a whistle before the snap. I think Sims took a step about half a second before he was supposed to. This will be a false start.
False start. Offense. Number 4. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Backs the Falcons up a little bit.
Still not back in their own territory, though.
Just to the 49-yard line.
Well, obviously, Dan, the Falcons know that this is a new surface and they want to just ease it in. Let's only use one side of it at a time, okay? That makes sense. Second down, 13 now. Once again, McKnight goes in motion. Fake the pitch to him. Farr will keep it himself. Probably more of a busted play than by design, but it still picks up about 4. Call him out to the 46-yard line of the Bulldogs. It'll be second down and 10. Actually, excuse me, 3rd and 10.
TJ Farr did have a reputation as a mobile quarterback at Monty Tech, where he was, of course, the Bulldogs.
You know, we saw that right there on the snap, Dan. I think Farr had a little bit of trouble handling that snap, and it threw off the timing just enough that he couldn't deliver the pitch that he wanted to. And he decided to take it himself. Or maybe it was always a designed run. Again, I'm a broadcaster, not a football coach. This time they fake the pitch. Flag is down, so this may be coming back. Farr ducks one sack, can't duck the other, just backhand flips it out of bounds. to nobody in particular.
Wonder if it might have been a free play. If maybe Dean had jumped there. Which may have been part of the motivation for Farr wanting to get a pass off no matter what.
If it was an illegal procedure on the Falcons, they would have stopped it. So I think the fact that the snap, the flag went off right at the line of scrimmage, so it's either illegal formation or Dean was offside.
Offsides, defense, number 95. 5-yard penalty, repeat third down.
Zion Edison, the sophomore from Detroit, the guilty party.
So TJ Farr is running this knowing it's basically a no-risk play, which is why he's trying so hard to get the ball off. But as you can see, a lot of players clad in white with the pressure. And then, you know, he sees the one player on the near side, wants to try to get a pass off of some sort, but as we saw, the pressure came.
At that point, he knows he's out of the pocket, and he knows an incomplete pass is better than a sack, so he's just getting rid of the football. It'll be third down and 5 after the offside. Farr will go from the shotgun for the first time. Straight drop, looks to his left, throws that way to the sideline, incomplete. Looked like he was trying to find Sahir Gomez.
Sahir Gomez, and from my look of it, it looked like he may have blew a tire trying to make the turn, as if maybe he realized late that the route wasn't quite right that he was trying to run.
Yeah, it looked like Gomez was running that comeback, and either he took a step too much or Farr got rid of the ball a step too soon. But now 4th and 5 for the Falcons at about the 41-yard line. Fitchburg State is lined up to punt, but, you know, TJ Farr, who is their quarterback now, is also the punter, so, you know, just got to watch out. Low snap, Farr runs up and will kick it himself. Line drive kick taken in at about the 15-yard line. This is Quintus Reed on the return. He's got plenty of blocks. He's across the 40 into Falcon territory, dragged down from behind at the 42-yard line. A tremendous return for Quintus Reed sets the Bulldogs up in great position with 13-13 to play here on Mockingbird Lane.
Last season, Reed, the senior from New Haven, Connecticut, his longest punt return of 8 was 11 yards. Got way more than 11 that time. There was a point where Farr was the last man back, and he was able to slow him down just enough that Nicholas Polanco was able to wrap him up.
First and 10 for the Bulldogs now at the Fitchburg State 43-yard line. Again, folks, we apologize. There's been some scoreboard difficulties here at Elliott Field, so we're unable to show you the down and distance, but we'll do our best to keep you apprised of the situation. Pitch to the near side. This, once again, is Reed on the carry. He gets some good blocks, turns the corner across the 35, and he's brought down at about the 33-yard line. It's a gain of very close to 10 yards. I think they're going to call it 2nd and short. Looks like it is going to be about 2nd down and a foot.
It seems the Bulldogs have been doing pretty well at finding openings downfield. They've had a couple of penalties against them, but other than that,
I think they could have had another one there. We saw one of the linemen was grabbing a Falcon by the jersey. Went uncalled. It'll be 2nd and 1 now. Handoff up the middle. Not much doing there, but they don't need much for the first down. Keyshawn Bullard, I believe, has enough to move the chains.
Probably only looking for a yard or two, but a yard or two is all he really needs.
Finally brought down by Calvin Guillaume. Take another look at it again. This time the Falcons do a great job sealing the edge, forcing Bullard back toward the center of the play. And he is actually not at the chains. So that is no gain for him. It is now 3rd down.
Yep. Stick seems to be just past the 33-yard line. Ball is spotted just short of the 33.
Bulldogs go shotgun. Bullard runs straight up the middle into absolutely nothing. There was a big green wall between him and the line of scrimmage, and he was driven down for a loss of 2. And one of the members of that wall is slow to get up.
I was curious. He hesitated for a moment, waiting for something to open up, but it was nothing but green shirts. And no chance there.
Sebastian Burmester is the injured Falcon. He was one of the men leading that assault on Bullard. Burst through the line and drove him down. But it looks like he hurt himself in the process. Seabass, a sophomore linebacker from Germantown, New York. We'll take a look at this again. See, the Falcon defense brings the blitz, and unblocked is Cameron Topkin. Burmester gets through. And I think, yeah, right there, the pile's falling down on top of him. Hard to see exactly what happened, but obviously when you're at the bottom of a pile in football, anything can happen, and very few of those things are good. So we'll keep an eye on him, hope he comes back okay. Meanwhile, back on the field here, it is fourth and two now.
We set the play clock to 40 seconds. 40 seconds. We set the play clock to 40 seconds.
All right, we are back here, fourth down and two. Bulldogs are at the Falcon 35-yard line. Shotgun snap, handoff goes to Bullard, running to his right. He dives forward. It's going to be very close, comes down to the spot. I think he's got it, Dan. That'll be a first down for Dean.
They give him the 32-yard line. It looked like Minette was always so close to stopping him, but he just ended up being a step behind as Bullard able to use his speed to elude him just for long enough that the Bulldogs able to get the first down.
Came down to that one-on-one matchup, and Bullard was able to do just enough and lunge just far enough forward that he picks up the first down.
It's just Dean's second of the night. It feels like they've had more than that.
First and 10, Bulldogs at the Falcon 32. McDermott going for the end zone. Jump ball. That ball comes down way out of bounds. It is going to be incomplete no matter who caught it.
They actually switched quarterbacks on that. Nathan Sisko was the one who threw that ball.
That is correct. Nathan Sisko, the junior from Franklin, Tennessee, he takes a shot at the end zone. He was trying to hit Moses Mooney. I think Mooney did make the catch, but he was about 2 feet out of bounds.
Jan Vals had the coverage for Fitchburg State, 5 feet, 5 inches tall, the freshman from Worcester Tech.
Now second down, handoff goes up the middle, this time for Bullard. Not much doing there. Gain of maybe two or three, good second effort for him.
Looks like two's all they're giving on that one.
Credit Guillaume with the tackle again. We'll take another look here.
I've been thinking that maybe they would be going more pass heavy, but it feels like they are finding more comfort in the run game right now, especially with Keyshawn Bullard.
You see Keyshawn Bullard has been the focal point of the offensive attack for Dean to this point. It'll be third and about nine for the Bulldogs. They need the 22. Sisko throws to the right, passes a little bit high. Still a very catchable ball. Went through the hands of Cam Fong, the senior receiver from Covington, Georgia.
Just a quick throw to the right side, and so Sisko not having as much luck. McDermott, one of five.
I tell you, Dan, these Bulldogs, they like them some tall quarterbacks. Sisko's 6'3", McDermott 6'1". It's a pretty tall drink of water there, but under center.
And a very diverse roster coming from all around the country as well.
Dan, are they lining up to attempt a 49-yard field goal? This is Division III, right?
Yep.
Is that legal in Division III?
If you can kick their first charge timeout of the half.
If you can kick a 49-yard field goal, how are you in Division III?
Look, Nikolai Look, the freshman from Middlebury, Vermont, is the man lined up to kick that field goal. Dean didn't return any of their kickers from last year. They only returned their punter. And they call timeout here. Yeah, this has been a pretty interesting game. It's been well worth the wait.
It's been a heck of a game so far. A very encouraging performance on both sides of the ball from Fitchburg State. And again, we have to temper our enthusiasm. We have to consider opposition and all of that from the Fitchburg perspective. Dean is a team that was 2-8 last year. Those two victories came against teams that otherwise went winless. At the same time, one of those victories came against you guys, and it was 42-6. So the fact that we're oh, let's call it a third of the way through this football game. And to be honest, it kind of feels like Fitchburg State has dominated it. You have to feel good about that if you're a Falcon fan.
Obviously, still lots of football to be played and a 49-yard field goal attempt to be made.
Okay. I'm sure we've seen weirder things, probably. Nikolai Luksch from Middlebury, Vermont. Kick is up. It has just barely not enough leg. It is no good. Falcons will take over with pretty good field position.
Remember the last time we saw someone try a field goal on FATV? It was Fitchburg and St. John's of Shrewsbury. And the kicker, whose name just escaped out of my head, he's at Holy Cross now, just to show how good of a leg he has. Sam LaValle, I think it was. He tried 50, and he got the same result that Nikolai Luksch got.
Well, you know, nothing ventured, nothing gained. Would have been good from, 44.
Yeah.
He's probably got a 45-yard leg in him. That's still pretty good.
It's a luxury to have for a Division III team.
I tell you what. For Fitchburg State, they have the luxury of possession of the football. First and 10 for the Falcons at their own 31-yard line. Easy McDonough in motion. Trouble with the snap is Wilson, and he is under pressure and immediately brought down. Joe Penton is the man delivering the hit. By the way, that was indeed Logan Wilson back as the signal caller for the Falcons.
Try to switch it up a little bit. That's not quite high. Also of note, Wilson is 3 inches shorter than TJ Farr. 6 feet tall is Farr, 5'9 is Wilson. And obviously the time taken to corral that ball was just enough for Dean to be able to come up with the stop and force a big loss of yardage.
Now second down 15, McKnight goes in motion again, but they go handoff straight up the middle. Frank Sims gets across the 30 to maybe the 31-yard line, give him a gain of, 3 yards. It'll be third and about 12 for Fitchburg State. And now the eternal question, Dan, screen pass or draw?
I'd like to see a pass on third down. This comes down to whether or not Wilson can find someone open.
Low snap, Wilson rolls to his right. He's going long, jump ball incomplete. Might have been a little bit of miscommunication there. McKnight stopped as though he was running a hook. Wilson just let it fly. Pass wound up about 10 yards downfield from him and the nearest Bulldog. There is a defender down at about the 30-yard line. I can't quite see who that is, Dan.
That is Darren Apia.
Darren Apia, the sophomore from Worcester, St. John's alum.
And he played in that game that we had just referenced, too. He was a standout for the Pioneers. And that was a ball that found Wilson. I think the arm is a little wild out of him as he threw that basically between Zaire McKnight. Too far for Zaire McKnight, not far enough for Sahir Gomez, who was the other Falcon in the nearest vicinity.
See Apia there getting helped off by Keem Weeks, his fellow safety. Injury bug biting both sides here, unfortunately, here in the early stages of the second quarter. Falcons lead 7-0, 9:28 to play in the first half. By all likelihood, about to kick it away to the Bulldogs. I know we talked about Fitchburg State liking the fake punt. It's 4th and 12 at your own 30. So,
the longest amount of time the Falcons have spent in their own half of the field in this contest.
Quintus Reed back deep to return for the Bulldogs. TJ Farr gets the kick. Let's go. Long, booming one angled away from Reed. It bounces at the 30 and is going to take a Falcon roll. Finally picked up at the Bulldog 20-yard line. Reed cuts back across the 30 and is finally met by a flock of Falcons, and he will be brought down at about the 33-yard line. Give him a 13-yard return, and Dean will take over first and 10.
We've seen three different flavors of punts from TJ Farr thus far, and that one was by far and away the best delivered, as There may have been a moment where I thought, is Reed too far back at this moment? As it turned out, he was not far back enough, or on the right side of the field.
It was a very impressive punt. It had the distance, but it was also angled away from him. It's a very difficult move as a punter. It's almost like a quarterback. If you're rolling to your right and then kicking to your left, it's very difficult. But Farr was able to do it that time.
It's great for a 50-yard punt there.
Nathan Cisco remains the quarterback for the Bulldogs. First and 10 for them. Handoff goes up the right side to Holden Wilson. Gets across the line of scrimmage. Not much more than that. Dan, did you ever read The Catcher in the Rye?
A very long time ago.
Okay, well, I've never read The Catcher in the Rye, so it is incumbent upon you to make Catcher in the Rye jokes whenever Holden Wilson gets the ball.
The last time I read Catcher in the Rye, I must have been in high school.
Okay.
Which would have been 15 years ago.
You're the one who said it, not me. Second down and 9 for Dean. Play fake by Cisco, throws to the right side, pass is complete. Cross midfield into Falcon territory, and finally dancing out of bounds is Jordan Mason. Good gain for him. Looks like they're going to stop him at about the Fitchburg State 47-yard line. Easily enough to move the chains. Take a look at this one.
Mason, the tight end, over 500 receiving yards last season. But he's got a lot of good mobility.
Just a quick play action fake and a designed tight end screen. Nice little confidence boosting pass for the backup quarterback, Cisco, who is brought in to replace Darren McDermott. First and 10 Bulldogs at the Falcon 47. Play fake, Cisco wants to keep it himself. He gets out to about the 45-yard line. Both teams mixing in just a little bit of option in their offensive attack. We saw McDermott try it earlier. The Falcons turned it over on an option pitch in the first quarter.
We don't really know what the book is on Cisco and how mobile he is. Had no compiled statistics from last season.
Well, just from the eye test from his first couple series, he doesn't have, you know, a ton of mobility, but, you know, it's all relative. He's a human. He can move. Second down and 8. Handoff goes to Holden straight up the middle. He's plowing through tacklers. Actually turned a Falcon around, pointed him with him. And he gets a first down and then some. Best run of the night for Holden Wilson. Junior from Spanish Fort, Alabama. Dan, did you know that they allow Spain to have forts in Alabama? Is that like an embassy, but with more guns? Sorry, back to live action here as I'm busy making jokes. It's a handoff straight up the middle, gets out to about the 30-yard line. That was, once again, Holden Wilson, the ball carrier.
Seems like on different drives, we're seeing different players also become the lead running back. We saw a lot of Keyshawn Bullard. But now we're seeing a lot of Holden Wilson after he had his best run of the night there. Now he's got another run to keep the drive moving for Dean.
We also see Will Stafford, who's currently lined up to the left side of Cisco in the backfield. Second down and 6 for the Bulldogs. And it will be Stafford taking the ball to himself. Looks to a hole to the right side. Can't really find anything. Turns the corner and gains a couple of yards. I think both sides will be relatively happy with that result. Fitchburg State defense is happy that they were able to keep Stafford from turning the corner, and the Bulldogs are happy they got anything out of it.
Stafford, a freshman from Whitman, Massachusetts. Whitman Hansen is the high school he attended. Exercise science major as well. It's a good amount of diversity in the majors that Dean has as well. There's even a sports broadcasting major on this team.
I think he was one of the ones who committed a false start earlier, right? Or hold something like that?
I don't think so.
Third down and 5. Stafford straight up the middle, gets great blocking this time. He's into the second level before he's even touched, and he's across the 20 before he's brought down. It'll be a first down. Bulldogs stop the clock, move the chains with 5:53 to play here in the first half.
Feels like they either get stuffed or they get a good number of yards on these runs. That sounds like I'm describing just about everything, but it's not quite just everything.
High snap, but Cisco does a good job, hands it off to Stafford, but he's not going to get much. He's brought down at the 19 by a couple of Falcons. Looks like Luke Noyes was among them.
Noyes was the first to arrive and had him wrapped up quite well. Looks like it will be a run of nothing on first down.
Officially no gain. It brings up second down and 10. Take a look at it again. You see Noyes makes the first hit. And then Jordan Cummings is there to clean it up. Now on second down, Cisco wants to throw to his right. Hit as he throws, but the pass is on target anyway. Delivered there to Moses Mooney. And Mooney's got himself a first down. It'll be first and goal now for the Bulldogs. So stop the clock, drop the chains. But there's a hold everything. There's a flag back in the backfield at about the 24-yard line. Typically from that position, this ball's coming back.
The distance that he walked, though, makes me wonder.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, on the defense, number 8. Penalty be forced at the end of the run, half the distance to the goal, automatic, first down.
So Sebastian Burmester is the guilty party. Good to see him back on the field after he suffered that injury earlier, although this might not be the way he wanted us to find out.
It ends up adding 4 yards to the end of that, so just 12 feet separate Dean from the end zone.
Cameron takes the handoff and he walks in basically untouched. Touchdown Dean, Will Stafford, a 4-yard touchdown run, and the Bulldogs are an extra point away from tying this game up.
We saw a lot of great stuff out of Keyshawn Bullard when they were going with him, but this time they hold him out on this drive. Holden Wilson and Will Stafford do pretty well. The holes open up, well done by the Dean O-line.
You saw a fantastic block there by Anthony Morrow, just absolutely pancaking his man. Now the extra point attempt. Each kick is up and it is good. So with 4:56 to play here in the game, in the first half rather, Nikolai Lukch has tied this game at 7. And just like that, Dan, the Bulldogs are back in it. You're usually happier when I say that, you know?
Usually is the case. By the way, that reminds us about the games that are upcoming here on FATV.
There are oh so very many of them.
Yep, and next week we're going to have 2 football games coming to you. On Thursday night, it will be the 141st meeting of the rivalry, Fitchburg and Lemonster, live from Crocker Field, 7 o'clock start. And then the following night, we're going to have the home opener from the Fitchburg-Westminster line. It's my old stomping grounds of Monty Tech hosting the Blue Devils of Murdoch High School. A Blue Devil twofer, how about that? That's a 6 o'clock kickoff from Bulldog Field.
We're going to have so many teams, so many games here on FATV. This is the first of many. Fitchburg State University, Fitchburg High School, Monty Tech, St. Bernard's. So many teams in and around Fitchburg. All here, all on FATV. Full schedule available at FATV.org. Absolutely, folks, encourage you as much as you can. Tune in, get your fill of Fitchburg football this fall here on FATV. Nikolai Lukch will kick it away. It's a high end-over-end kick, taken in at about the 10-yard line. Plenty of room to run in front of him. Gets across the 25 to about the 28-yard line. Pretty good return there for Keyshawn McCurdy. It's from a... So get this, Dan. Keyshawn McCurdy is from Augusta, Georgia, went to high school in Orange, New Jersey, and his nickname is Texas.
It comes from a military family.
That sounds about right.
Yep. His brother was born in Germany. He's traveled the country, he's traveled the world. A tremendous background there for Keyshawn McCurdy.
Falcon offense back on the field now, first and 10 at their own 28-yard line. They come straight from the sideline into formation. Logan Wilson, pump fake, wants to go long. He's got McKnight wide open, caught at the 35, and he's going to go in untouched. Touchdown, Falcons, just like that.
One play, one score. Elijah Zaire McKnight was wide focused open down the near side. Just had to find him, and he did.
Dan, that play, McKnight just makes it look
easy,
effortless, not difficult. There's got to be a word for it.
I wonder if we've invested in a thesaurus lately.
take a look at it again. Wilson delivers the pump fake. Honestly, it's just a great play, even from the concept stage. You wait until the last moment, run out from the sideline into formation. Don't give Dean a chance to react. McKnight winds up wide open. DeKeel's extra point attempt is up and through. And Dan, we have spent one play tied at 7. Fitchburg has now taken the lead.
We've been mentioning Logan Wilson's passes tonight. The long balls have been a little bit inconsistent. That one was right where it needed to be.
There was nobody within 20 yards of Easy McKnight when he made that catch. 20 might be an understatement. He was so effing open.
That was just a tremendous throw. And that credit to the O-line there. How much time did Logan Wilson have to throw that football? Last season, I guarantee you, he would not have had that time. And that just is a testament to how hard this offensive line has worked in the offseason to get bigger, to get stronger, and to make those plays possible.
We mentioned at the start of the broadcast, Dan, head coach Scott Sperone has been very insistent that the offensive line needed to get better. It all starts on the line, and the line held up there. Wilson delivered the pass, McKnight did the rest. It really did look easy, and now the Falcons have the lead once again.
Last time they kicked off, it was an onside kick that worked. It's DeKeel out there again.
I think they're lining up for a more traditional kick this time, but that only means so much. Flag on the kick. Looks like the Falcons may have been offside. They'll pitch it back. Will the Bulldogs returned out to about the 34-yard line, but something tells me the Bulldogs might be getting another shot at this. Flag thrown right at the moment of the kickoff usually indicates some manner of malfeasance by the kicking team. We'll see just exactly what it was. Illegal procedure indicated on the Falcons.
So Dean's got options here on what they would like to do. So the referee will talk with head coach Andre Murphy. And they'll go over the options and figure out what selection he would like to make.
See if we can spot it here. And actually, you can see right there, the second guy from the end on the far left side of your screen, you can see there, he's about a full step over the line right as the ball is kicked.
Illegal formation on the kicking team. Not within 5 yards of the kicking line. 5-yard penalty will be added to the end of the run. First down.
I'm sorry, what? Not within 5 yards of the kicking line?
I think they may have felt that the player may have actually lined up too far away from the ball. You are limited to a 5-yard run-up if you are not the kicker.
I see.
And so in the end, after the options, I think it was either 5 yards back in re-kick or 5 yards to the end. And ultimately, with the ball going to the 35, start at the 40? Yeah.
That sounds like fun. We'll take that.
We'll go with that.
Sisko takes the snap, play fake, pass to the left side is high, but it is caught. Brought in by Quintus Reed, tries in vain to shake his man, but he drags him into Falcon territory before finally being brought down. It's a great game for the Bulldogs. Both of these offenses starting to open up the game a little bit. Take another look at this one.
See in the option, the play action, Quintus Reed. He's the most dangerous of the receivers. They have 667 yards last season on 52 catches and does a tremendous job in shaking off Jalen Miller for long enough to get all those yards after the catch.
Now on first down, it's Moses Mooney, the ball carrier. There's a flag down pretty much right at the moment of the tackle. It's a gain of about 5, but I think we can safely say it's not going to be 5. Will it be 20? Will it be negative 5? Who knows? It will be negative 5.
You get to keep the down.
Holding. Offense. Number 4. 10 yards in the spot of the foul. First down.
Jordan Mason, the guilty party.
I think that's his second one tonight. As I'm thinking about it, the sports broadcasting major on the team is Ryan Coughlin, senior running back from Taunton, number 83.
Gage Maxfield as well.
Ah, more than one.
That's right.
Yep. And you were right about that. I was thinking of the other guy.
First down and about 16 now for the Bulldogs. They're at the Falcon 43. Cisco takes the snap, looks to his right, pumps, now looking over the middle, under pressure, dragged down, and he is sacked. Loss of about 5 yards after the sack.
Even Nildo Demora came up with it, the longest tenured Falcon. He's the only player on the team who was on the 2018 squad who is still here at Fitchburg State.
Great coverage downfield enables Demora to finally find a hole in the offensive line. And when he gets through there, he makes it count. It's now second and, 20, 21.
Second in Bellingham?
That sounds about right. Play fake, Cisco looking to pass. Under pressure once again, rolls to his right. He is dragged down in his own territory this time. Luke Noyes turns up the volume here at Elliott Field. It's a big loss. Okay, it is now third in Bellingham.
I'm thinking Hopedale now.
Okay, all right.
It's third and they're into Worcester County.
Third and halfway home for me? Are we that far?
Working on it.
Noyes brings Cisco down back at his own 44-yard line. They need to get to the 27 of the Falcons for a first down. So I suppose officially it is third and 33. What's in the playbook for third and 33? Handoff straight up the middle. It's a gain of a couple, and they'll probably kick it away.
Give it to number two and see what happens, but it's like Bullard gets some good runs in this game, but he's had some not so good runs, and that was one of the not so good runs. It was positive. It wasn't nearly positive enough.
Cam Minette made the hit for the Falcons. And now as we duck under 2 minutes to play here in the second quarter, worth remembering a couple of things. First of all, the Bulldogs will get the ball back to start the third quarter. And secondly, as you can see on your screen, Fitchburg State has already burned two of their timeouts. So if you were thinking about maybe a 90-second drill, I suppose anything's possible. It's a high, booming punt. Fair catch called for and made at about the 15-yard line. Dan, I will bet you every dollar I have in my wallet, including all of my credit cards, that the Falcons come out and either kneel or hand it off straight up the middle.
I feel your wallet's quite empty.
I said credit cards.
Is zero a number for that?
You can probably buy some things before I call Discover and say, help me, I've been robbed.
It was Aaron Fonseca who had the punt, by the way, the junior from Cranston, Rhode Island. I mentioned they brought back a punter from last year. That wasn't him.
Of course not. So Fitchburg State's offense back out on the field. Handoff goes to Sims, running to his right. He's across the 15, brought down at about the 16-yard line. Bulldogs do have a couple of timeouts, so they could theoretically force Fitchburg to give them the ball back with maybe 15 seconds left, but they frankly seem disinterested in the concept.
At the very least, I think they're happy with the one-yard stop on first down, and I think they want to wait and see what this second down brings them before they start burning the timeouts. If you have two timeouts left, there's got to be one play where you're not going to call one. So
that's true. So we are under 1 minute to play here in period number two as the Falcons come to the line. Second down and 9. McKnight goes in motion. Handoff to Sims straight up the middle across the 20. Brought down at about the 22-yard line. It'll be a gain of 5 for him.
And I guess Dean really isn't going to call those timeouts.
Yeah, Dean is not interested in stopping the clock anymore. They will take it to the locker rooms, and we will follow them there. Fitchburg State will take a 14-7 lead into halftime. All things being equal, Dan, It was a rare sight last season. Only two times did Fitchburg State put up 14 points in a game. They've put up 14 points here in the first half against Dean. There's a long way to go for this team.
That's the end of the first
but
half.
But this is a positive development for the Fitchburg State Falcons.
As we said, optimism seems to be in the air, and they did well to manufacture that drive at the end of the first quarter, found with Elijah Zaire McKnight finding his way into the end zone for the touchdown. And then right after Dean retorted and tied the game, 15 seconds, that's as much time as the game was tied. 73 yards, Logan Wilson to Elijah Zaire McKnight. It had been mentioned that Elijah Zaire McKnight had been sorely missed. He was out for the season after suffering an elbow injury just a few games
in.
We
put 20 minutes on the clock. 20 minutes
that,
on the game clock.
Just to see him back.
McKnight means so much to this Falcon offense. You really saw how he was missed last season. And now that he has returned, it is a new look and a new hope for Fitchburg State on the offensive side of the ball. But it is not a one-man show. There are plenty of positives on, you know, frankly, not just the offensive side, but both sides of the ball. Mm-hmm. So Fitchburg State taking a 14-7 lead into halftime. We will take the break with the players. Come on back when we can. But folks, if you are in Fitchburg, absolutely come on down to Elliott Field, but anywhere in the world, FATV.org is your place to go for the second half of action. It's Fitchburg State University football right here on FATV. We are back here at Elliott Field on the campus of Fitchburg State University, where it is 14-7 Fitchburg State as we get ready for the second half of action. I'm John Gugerty, joined, of course, by Dan Bolak. And Dan, just setting aside the scores for a second, this was a good, competitive, entertaining first half of football. And in and of itself, that is a big step forward for this program.
Indeed, and for Fitchburg State, I believe only once did they lead at the half last season, and that was in the Worcester State game that they would much rather like to forget. In this contest, the Falcons have been doing well in manufacturing drives. They've made some good plays occur. Elijah Zaire McKnight, though, has been the focal point of this offense for the green and gold. He's got three rushes for 24 yards, but also three catches for 86, including a 73-yard strike. That was just a perfect response to Dean tying the score.
It was a fantastic response, and I really want to go back and talk about just the play design getting into that play, Dan. We noticed even before Fitchburg State came out, they let the play clock run down, 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 and they were just kind of standing at the sideline, and you even saw Dean's defense just kind of looking around like, okay, where the heck are these guys? There's like 10 seconds on the play clock. And then finally the Falcons run out from the sideline straight into formation. They give the Bulldogs no time to react. And then on top of that, they run a deceptive play on top of their deceptive formation, right? They do a pump and go, catch the Bulldogs totally flat-footed. That was a really well drawn up and really well strategized play. You know, so much of football and so much of football play calling and strategizing is about X's and O's and manipulating players on the field once the ball is live. That was a great example of manipulating players and moving them around even before the snap. And that's the kind of interesting, creative thinking that, frankly, you didn't see a lot of from Fitchburg State last season, and I would love to see more of from the Falcons this season as they look to build a more winning program here at Fitchburg State.
And one of the challenges last year was there were just so few players that really had Division III experience, so many first-year players on this squad. So it takes time to learn the playbook and build that out. And even this season now, having about half the team be returning players, you have a little more knowledge. Players are a little more up to speed. You can expand the playbook. I knew that Coach Barone had told me, we've added the pistol. It almost sounded like that was just one of those, oh, by the way, we've added this. I still thought they were going to be going out of the flexbone primarily. They've been primarily going out of the pistol.
No, I don't think we've seen the straight-up flexbone at all. We've seen the Falcons go under center a few times with like a single back or a broken eye formation, but that old flexbone formation has not really played a big factor for Fitchburg State when they've had the ball.
So looking at the first half stats, 145 yards of offense on 28 plays for the Falcons, 118 yards of offense on 31 plays for Dean, 98 through the air for Fitchburg, and 59 on the ground for the Bulldogs, exactly half of 118, so 59 rushes as well, 47 rushing yards for the Falcons. And for Dean, Keyshawn Bullard, 9 carries for 45 yards, is the leader there. But it was Will Stafford who got the touchdown that tied the score. And for Fitchburg, as we mentioned, Elijah Zaire McKnight's been the big game breaker there. Logan Wilson is 5 for 7 through the air for 98 yards.
Before we get underway here in the third quarter, I want to thank once again our underwriters. FATV's remote productions are underwritten by Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance, Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise. We are ready for football here in the third quarter from Elliott Field. Falcons lining up, and they will try the quick onside again. It once again bounces off a Bulldog. That's still a live ball at midfield. I believe it is fallen on by Dean, and there's a flag down way back at the right end zone at about the 7-yard line. The referee threw a flag way back on the right side. Might have seen an illegal block or something from back there, but we'll check the infraction.
An unusual place to put a penalty flag.
Illegal formation on the kicking team. Less than 4 players on one side. 5 yards to be added to the end of the kick. First down.
So we mentioned, Dan, that the Falcons have had some success with onside kicks. But they did not get what they were looking for that time. Dean falls on the football, and apparently the Falcons committed a foul just in running up to the ball. So the Bulldogs will have it first and 10 at the Fitchburg 45.
Need to have at least 4 players on each side of the football, and the referees felt that one of the sides of the football didn't have that.
First and 10 Bulldogs at the Falcon 45, pretty much directly in front of us here from the press box at Elliott Field. Sisko takes the shotgun snap, handoff straight up the middle. Goes to Keyshawn Bullard. He's been the focal point of the ground game for Dean throughout most of the first half. Actually, excuse me, that was Will Stafford, the ball carrier. Stafford played a part as well. I'm sorry, Dan, go ahead.
Yeah, the touchdown there. Just going with the run up the middle. It was a good second effort. He was originally stuffed at the line, but kept his feet churning and got a couple extra yards.
Nathan Sisko, the junior, took over after Darren McDermott was ineffective on his first couple of series. He'll keep it himself on second down, and that is not going to be the right decision. He is dragged down in the backfield for a loss of about 7.
Cameron Topkin again. He's been just about everywhere for the Falcons defense in the first half. He had 6 tackles, 2 tackles for a loss, make that 3 now, and he had that interception as well.
Topkin comes in, he delivers the first hit, and then it's Jalen Miller who's able to finish the job. Negates the gain on first and a little bit more. It'll be third down and 12 now for the Bulldogs. Sisko from the shotgun, rolls to his right away, chucks a pass to his right, pass is caught. Did he keep a foot in bounds? Yes, he did. It's a very good catch there by Moses Mooney, and it'll be a first down for the Bulldogs.
Sisko able to buy enough time as he rolled out to the right side, and Mooney set himself up in the correct spot, able to keep his feet in bounds and earn a first down for the Bulldogs, and they're threatening again now inside the 30-yard line.
Gets Dean to the Fitchburg 28-yard line where they will have it first and 10. Handoff once again to Stafford. Goes up the middle, then bounces to his right. It's across the 25, not much further than that. Luke Noyes makes the hit for the Falcons.
I feel like there's a better way to word it, but it feels like running plays for Dean either will get you at least 10 yards or will get you less than 5.
It's very boom or bust on the ground game for the Bulldogs at the moment, but it averages out to a pretty decent number. Second down and 7 now, Stafford again. This time good blocking, gets him into the second level. Second effort gets him down to about the 20-yard line. It's a gain of 6 for him. It'll be third and about 2.
Fitchburg State baseball team making their presence felt here as they travel through the assembled home fans, try to sell some beverages. Back on the field, it is third down and two for the Bulldogs. Will Stafford remains the running back to the left of Cisco. He gets the carry. He's got a huge hole. Cuts to his left. He's across the 15, across the 10, still on his feet. Finally brought down at about the 6-yard line. But that is a big gain for him. It'll be first and goal for the Bulldogs. Take another look at this one.
It does seem to come down to how well the Dean O-line is able to open up those holes on the defensive line.
And you saw there from the end zone camera, there was nobody in his way. Stafford gets it on first down again. This time the Falcon defense is able to swallow him up. He's across the 5 down to the 4. It'll be second down and goal.
Stafford's had the momentum on this drive. The freshman in his collegiate debut doing quite well to help build up this Dean offense. Try to get them tied again.
Second down and goal now. Cisco calling signals from the shotgun. Hands off to Safford, straight up the middle. He is in untouched. Touchdown, Bulldogs.
Felt like a carbon copy of their first touchdown from Stafford, just running right up the middle from 4 yards out. And again, that time Dean doing a tremendous job to open up that hole like a curtain opening night. There's the show. And they're a point away from tying it.
Don't get many easier scores than that. Nikolai Lukes will come on to attempt the extra point. Kick is up and through. So less than 4 minutes into the third quarter, we are tied once again, 14 aside. This Dean offense, Dan, looks like they have figured some things out here.
I know there was a point when they got their second first down of the night, and I thought to myself, it feels like they should be a little better than that in terms of getting first downs. They've had a lot of successful plays. It's just been a matter of getting those plays to occur consistently for them, and they occurred pretty consistently on that drive. Bullard seems to be the more flashier running back, but Stafford has been the more effective one, and he's got two scores to his name.
And really, it all comes down to the offensive line. You saw there on that second replay of the touchdown, Dean's offensive line just dwarfs Fitchburg State's defensive line. They are significantly bigger, significantly stronger, it seems. And when it all goes right for them, they just plow through the Falcons.
I would like to try to compare the weights of the Dean O-line, but apparently the weights are trade secrets.
Well, Lukes will kick it away. High end-over-end kick, taken in at about the 10-yard line. Cuts to his left side, gets a pretty good block across the 40, across midfield, one man to beat, but he is dragged down by the kicker. Nikolai Lukes with a touchdown saving tackle, pretty much right at midfield, but a tremendous return for Keyshawn McCurdy gives the Falcons excellent field position.
Had a feeling that Lukes pulled him down by the helmet, but regardless, it's a tremendous run back there for McCurdy, who's showing himself off to be an explosive kick returner.
I don't think you're the only one who thought that, Dan. The Falcon coaches are about 4 feet to the left of us in the box here. They were upset. There was a Falcon coach down at the sideline who had his arms above his head and was screaming at the referee.
I think, looking at his body language, I think McCurdy feels the same way.
Logan Wilson back in at quarterback. Easy McKnight in motion. Try the option pitch to the near side. McKnight looking for a hole. He's going to be brought down after a loss of about a yard. Sometimes you run the triple option, you think you're going to find something good. All three choices had nothing positive. Fitchburg winds up losing a yard.
I think back to that Worcester State game from last year, and Fitchburg's running game was fairly solid in the first half of that game. But then Worcester State started loading the box, 7-8 players in there, and really trying to rush a lot of players, overwhelmed the O-line, and the Falcons couldn't get their offense running at that point. And you wonder how much Andre Murphy has talked with his team at halftime.
Logan Wilson under pressure, rolls to his right, wants to keep it himself, ducks out of one tackle, he's across midfield, spun down at about the 45-yard line of the Bulldogs. It's a 6-yard gain for the Fitchburg quarterback, makes it third down and 5.
On that play, we at least saw Wilson had time to work with it, at least to look downfield. Dean coverage was very solid, couldn't find any open receivers, and ultimately Wilson goes and runs with it. The Falcons do have mobile quarterbacks, and that does help. And Wilson spun down at the 45, able to get some good yards out of that, make it a manageable third and about five.
It was Joe Penton who ultimately made the hit for the Bulldogs. But it will be third down and five for Fitchburg. Frank Sims is the tailback. Wilson rolls to his left. Wants to throw that way. High lobbing pass intended for Sims. And how did he make that catch? There were three Bulldogs all around him. Frank Sims was falling down, but he brought it in just before it hit the turf. Take a look at this one again, Dan.
Seemed like he was throwing against his body, too. Just had to drop it in a bucket downfield and find Sims in the perfect spot. And Frank Sims is a very happy man. He's won his prize, a first down.
It's like a shortstop going back for an infield pop-up, you know? The left fielder's not going to get there. The center fielder's not going to get there. You've got to turn around and make the catch as you're falling down. But Frank Sims did it. First down Falcons now at the Bulldog 25. Wilson rolls to his left once again. He's going to keep it himself. Designed run. He is hit hard, and he might have been hit late. A flag comes in as Wilson is driven out of bounds. He's at about the 20-yard line. My gut tells me he's going to wind up at the 10. This could be a late hit against Dean.
And looking through my binoculars, I have nothing that refutes that. That means you can say that he's probably going to get the 10-yard line.
Hard to tell from our vantage here on the press box. We are at the near side. Play occurred back on the far side toward that back right corner. But given the timing of the flag.
There's no foul on the play. Contact was made inbounds. Therefore, there's no foul.
Fair enough.
Second down.
Contact came inbounds, so it is no foul. It's a good hard hit. We'll take a look at it again. I think this was a designed QB run all the way.
No, he's out. He was out of bounds there.
He was driven out of bounds, and then I think you could argue that the defender initiated the move when he was in bounds, but he did not hit him in bounds.
I don't think so either.
Nevertheless, we persist. It is a second down and five for Fitchburg. Handoff goes to Sims trying that jet sweep, but he is not going to get anything out of it. Blown up in the backfield. I think Matt Blake was the first man there. There were a couple other Bulldogs on top of him. We've seen the Falcons try these tricky plays to get the ball in the hands of Easy McKnight plenty of times. Now they try a jet sweep to get it in the hands of Sims. That is not going anywhere.
I think that
was actually Joe Penton, excuse me.
Yeah, and Penton has had a very first good half in terms of defense, and he continues to play that role.
Loss of a yard. It'll be third down and six for the Falcons. They need the 15 for a first. Wilson rolling to his right, looks to throw. Now he'll take off, and he'll be pushed out of bounds. Across the 20, about the 17-yard line. Short of the line to gain. Probably go for it if you're Fitchburg, but
everyone is acting as if there's a flag somewhere, except I cannot see it.
It's entirely possible that there's a mass of humanity between us and the handkerchief.
Personal foul. Illegal low block on the offense, number four. 15 yards on the spot of the foul. Repeat. First down.
So that low block by Frank Sims.
First down?
That is what the gentleman in the white hat said. I do not believe that is what he intended. We'll take a look at it again. See, right there, Sims goes down a little bit too low, and the referee is right on top of it. You can even see him reaching in to pull the flag. So on the field, they do have it correct. It is third down and, oh boy, that's more than 15. Sims pitches it back to McKnight. Easy wants to chuck it up. He's got a man. Diving catch is made at the 12-yard line by Sahir Gomez. We saw McKnight throw one for Wilson in the first half that was incomplete. This time he finds his target, Sahir Gomez. They do the pitch out to Sims right there. He tosses it back to McKnight. He's got all day to set up and throw and just huck it downfield. Not the most aesthetically pleasing quarterback form, but hey, the ball got there. It's a first down for Fitchburg, and that's what matters. Back to live action now. First down Falcons at the 13. Sims plows forward. And he is stopped pretty much immediately. Give him a gain of a couple.
I know I have to think on third and a million, it wasn't going to be just a handoff to Sims to the left side for some yards. There had to be something more to it. It was the pitch back to Zaire McKnight, and Easy McKnight, you know, he wanted to get that pass off. He wanted to make something successful happen. He made something successful happen. And a tremendous development to, well, the gentleman said it was first down. It became first down after that.
You remember when Antoine Randall-L did that in the Super Bowl one year? That's what that pass reminded me of. Now on second down, Wilson donned the option. He chooses to keep it himself. There's a flag thrown in the backfield. Wilson is blown up before he can get much. We'll see what the penalty is, but usually when it's thrown from that direction, and when a Falcon player comes out gesticulating like that, it's not going to go well for Fitchburg State. Officials taking time to figure out exactly what the call's going to be here.
Personal foul, illegal block below the waist on the offense, number 4. 15 yards from the previous spot, second down.
That's the second time this drive that Frank Sims has been called for that, and this is pretty clear cut, Dan. You just can't do what Frank Sims is doing right here. He's going low, he's diving at the defender's knees. You can't do that. You gotta stop doing that.
The way that his body language is going, he feels like he's comfortable with that technique, but the officials have now told him twice that no, that technique is not allowed in American football.
No, that's how guys get their knees ruined. Second down and 23 now for the Falcons after the penalty. Wilson play fake under a lot of pressure, but he's setting up a screen to Sims, but it is blown up in the backfield. Dez Diaz did not fall for it. There's a flag down again. Frank Sims is beside himself.
I think this might be against Diaz for that gesture over the top of Sims.
Saw Kai Reeves shrugging his shoulders as if to say, what the heck was that?
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct on the defense, number 22. 15 yards on the dead ball spot. Automatic first down.
Nicholas Grimaldi is called the guilty party. Let's take a look at this again. Looks like it's a well set up screen, but Diaz is able to blow his man, and there you see right there, Grimaldi gets up in Sims's face. The flag is thrown even before Diaz can start his gesticulation. So I think it's a good call to call it on Grimaldi. You'll see it again here. Grimaldi gets right up in Sims's face, claps right into his face. You can't do that either, guys.
So a streak of indiscipline now coming across Elliott Field.
And that is a huge penalty because the yardage itself would not have been enough to give the Falcons a first down. They were backed up so far, but it carries with it an automatic first down. So all of that penalty yardage that Fitchburg lost is essentially negated. They have another first and 10. You remember what we were saying about entertaining, well-played football at halftime?
Yeah.
It's still entertaining.
Yeah, it's just a little indisciplined.
Just a little. It's the first game of the season. It's hot. It's late. Guys are tired. Guys are cranky.
It's too early for bedtime, though.
First and 10, pitch comes to McKnight, looking to bounce it out to his right side. He's wrapped up at about the 15-yard line by Nicholas Grimaldi. And get this, a flag has come in.
It's the most incredible thing.
A man has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface, indicating that someone may have committed an infraction against the rules.
This is a callback to last season, by the way.
I know. Memories. Good times. You want to make up team names for Dean for the rest of the fourth quarter? I think it's a little early in the season for us to reach that deep into the playbook.
We didn't even use the one they went with.
We didn't.
There's no foul on the play. Second down.
Okay, nothing happened. Let's take a look at it again, see what they may have called. See, McKnight gets wrapped up there. It's just a little bit of yelling, a little bit of not too happy. Oh, McKnight. I think they wanted to get McKnight for that push, and there's the flag right there. Honestly, I'm a little surprised they didn't get Dre Kidd for diving.
Maybe that's why they no-called it.
You know, Dre Kidd, he definitely gets pushed. He's up in his face, and McKnight is like, get off me. And then Kidd's like, oh, my God, I've been shot. This is the worst thing to ever happen. Meanwhile, back to live action, McKnight takes the swing pass off the left side, and he gets German suplexed from behind. Arn Anderson is apparently on defense for the Bulldogs. There's our first pro wrestling reference of the season. It's a gain of about 8 for McKnight.
It's one of those pure pass formations, setting up in the pistol, 3 receivers to the left side, wanting to hit that screen pass. 3-on-3 violence there.
I think Kidd delivered the shoulder block, and then Tyzon Poole came in from behind to finish it off with the suplex. It'll be 3rd down and 3 now for the Falcons. They can get a first down without getting a touchdown. Wilson, quick pass to the near side. He's got Ayire. Ayire across the 5-yard line. Dan, you would not believe it. The most incredible thing has happened. A man has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface, indicating that someone may have committed an infraction against the rules of football.
It would have been enough for a first down. I'll leave it there until our referee lets us know what's going on now.
Holding. Offense. Number 3. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. 3rd down.
Well, Easy McKnight has been so good at playing football in the first half that now that everybody's playing let's commit penalties, he decides let's do that too.
So there goes that what would have been a first down, but then again, the hold is probably what would have made it a first down.
That's a fair point.
So this has been a drive.
It certainly has.
It's not 6 holds in 8 plays hilarious, but it's getting there.
3rd down and about 10 now after the penalty. Fitchburg is at the 16. They need the 6 to move the chains. Wilson goes with an empty backfield for the first time today. Takes the shotgun snap, rolls to his left. Under pressure, dumps it off. Dan, the most incredible thing has happened. The man has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface, indicating that someone may have committed an infraction against the rules of American football. I'm gonna keep adding words every single time. It looks like Dre Kidd is slow to get up as well.
Are we getting to the point where the officials are going to have to get Scott Sperone and Andre Miller together to say?
Personal foul. Roughing the passer on the defense, number 8. The penalty enforced half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
This time it's Matt Blake guilty of the personal foul, and that once again gifts the Falcons with a first down. Dan, I don't think Fitchburg State has moved the ball in the last, like, 8 plays, but they keep picking up first downs. Let's take a look here. Wilson rolls to his left, and you can see he gets rid of the ball, and just after he does so, he is hit hard by Blake. Timing's just a little bit off there. And that is another automatic first down. Winds up being 1st and goal now for Fitchburg at the 5-yard line. 4:17 to play here in the 3rd quarter. We are knotted at 14. Fitchburg goes in the I formation, handoff to the fullback Sims. He plows forward to the right side, gains about 3 yards before he's brought down. It'll be 2nd and goal. I believe it was Antonio Carrillo who delivered the hit? Yes, indeed it was. Mr. Carrillo, the freshman from Lilburn, Georgia.
This will be a great test for the Dean defense here. Gonna stop the Falcons 3 more times in deep territory, or at least hope that Fitchburg starts committing penalties again. but they haven't been too spotless disciplinary-wise either.
Ayire in motion, flag on the snap, flag in the backfield. Sims is into the end zone, but nobody celebrate yet. I would be surprised if this one counts.
So another penalty flag, another conference on what this will be.
There are two fouls on the play. Offsides, defense. Illegal shift on the offense. Those penalties offset. Replay the down.
Had I mentioned, you know, the two teams have been rather indisciplined.
You had mentioned that once or twice, Dan.
Yep, and now we get the wonderful offsetting penalty because both teams have broken the rules of American football.
Well, you know, they have to get creative. Second and goal once again. Sims in the backfield, Ayire in motion. Timeout Fitchburg before the play.
Timeout, Dean. Their first charge timeout.
Well, the referee said timeout, Dean, but the side judge indicated timeout Fitchburg, so I'm confused.
Maybe he was trying to point towards the Dean bench as opposed to the right.
It does make sense that Dean would call timeout.
It's a weird drive. Let's go to a scoreboard update.
Let's.
So last time we checked it on Nichols and Westfield State, there was no scoring. There's lots of scoring now. It's 27-17 Westfield there in the third quarter down at one of the many alumni fields.
That is indeed a lot of scoring.
And meanwhile, at another alumni field, I do believe, in Worcester, it's WPI and Worcester State, and that one is not going very well for the MASCAC team. It's Worcester State 14 and WPI 45.
That is not at all good for the fans of the Lancers. But if there are any fans of the Lancers, or indeed anyone else who are looking for some exciting college football action here on a Friday night, we want to let you know that you can watch FATV programming in high definition on your streaming device, be that an Apple TV, Fire TV, or Roku. There is, of course, also the FATV app, plus the good old-fashioned FATV.org and look for the education stream. Feels weird to call live streaming video of any kind old-fashioned, but, you know, I remember when the internet wasn't a thing. Second down and goal, handoff to McKnight. He is going to be just short of the line. He did gain yardage, but not enough. It'll be third and goal inside the one-yard line.
Feels like he was just so short. Did not miss breaking the plane by very much. This feels like prime sneak opportunity.
It feels like bring TJ Farr on and have him take the snap and dive in. But, you know, we'll see what they do. Wilson stays under center, third and goal. They try the handoff to Sims, and Frank Sims walks in untouched. Touchdown, Falcons.
Very strange was it ended up being the referee who signaled it, because neither of the line referees wanted to do it. But he so clearly got in, and there were no yellow handkerchiefs on the field.
Nope. Frank Sims takes it in from a yard out, gives the Falcons the lead with 2:49 to play here in the third quarter. Dan, that drive felt like it lasted about half an hour. It only took about 5 minutes off the clock. Extra point attempt from DeKeel is up and through. Fitchburg extends the lead to 7, 21-14, Fitchburg State. Dan, the last time the Falcons put 21 points on anyone was that fateful Worcester State game back on September the 18th of last year.
So that was, what do you want to take away from that drive? That was just, it's mystifying.
Yes. I tell you what, if you want to look for a positive spin from the Fitchburg side, eventually they took advantage of the opportunities that were given to them. And they were persistent and dogged and determined enough to keep playing and keep trying, even after multiple instances of their own boneheadedness, including the same guy being called for the same illegal block twice, drove them back. And that guy wound up getting the touchdown because it was Frank Sims who drove it in.
14 plays, 50 yards in 8 minutes and 32 seconds.
Sure.
How do you... It's hard to do 14 plays and only get 50 yards. That's all they could have gotten anyway. But to do it in 8.5 minutes, that was the drive of a lifetime. Take from that what you will.
It took a lifetime. Dan, I'm fat and in my 30s. I can't afford to be giving lifetimes away on these drives. I like pizza too much. Keel with a short blooping kick picked up by one of the upmen at about the 38-yard line, not returned for much. I believe that was Giovanni Memnon? Yes, it was Giovanni Memnon, the junior from Port St. Lucie.
I will say with how Linnea DeKeel kicks off, there we've seen three or four different types of kickoffs, and you really don't know where that ball's going to go. Confusion, the power of Linnea DeKeel.
Let's just say there's a reason the Falcons try a lot of onside kicks. First and 10 for the Bulldogs at their own 41-yard line. Motion to the near side, but it's a handoff straight up the middle. Plows through one tackle across midfield into Falcon territory. Will Stafford with another really good run. Stop the clock, move the chains. It'll be first down Bulldogs at the Fitchburg 47.
So the freshman from Whitman continuing his successful running ways. And this time it's the 10 or more yard run, that variety.
I haven't really seen much of Keyshawn Bullard. He did pretty well for himself, but it's been the Will Stafford show the past couple quarters. Cisco play fake, wants to go deep on first down, passes a little bit underthrown, but the adjustment and the catch are both made. That is a great job by Quintus Reed. A tremendous catch for him, and a big gain down to about the 23-yard line.
Was it on their last drive that they were able to get a pass over into that area with the receiver able to just keep their feet in bounds, or was it a drive earlier? But that's not the first time we've seen that fish tonight. But it's a delicious fish for Dean College. It's worth a first down. Here's one of the minus five runs.
Hand off to Stafford. This time he gets absolutely nothing. I believe Cam Manette was the first one to meet him. Logan Perez was there as well. It's a loss of about five, just like you said, Danny. Boom or bust on the ground for these Bulldogs.
I would think they're probably going to keep giving it to Stafford, because with how he's been running tonight, I don't think they would expect him to go bust three times in a row.
Second down, they fake it and instead toss it to the near side. Great blocking, turns it upfield, dances along the sidelines, finally knocked out of bounds. Jordan Mason, a tremendous catch and run, will set up first down and I believe goal. They might spot him out of bounds just outside the 10, but it is definitely a first down for the Bulldogs.
It's always a great weapon to have a tight end who can come up with receptions and speed. The Falcons had such a tight end in Devin Samil several years ago, and what a playmaker he was. Jordan Mason shows me shades of that as he helps get the Bulldogs deep into Falcon territory.
Now Stafford on first down gets across the 10. He's brought down after a gain of about four. There is, however, a penalty marker on the play. Bulldogs were outside the 10, so it's not first and goal. I think it's about to be first and more than 10.
Holding, offense, number four. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. We play first down.
Of course, I praise Jordan Mason. He's called for his third hold of the night.
You either die a hero or you live one exact play longer and live to become the villain, apparently. Jordan Mason guilty of the hold, sets up first down and 20 for the Bulldogs. They're at the Fitchburg 23. Cisco takes the shotgun snap, play fake, throws to the right side, underthrown, but coming back for it and getting into the end zone. Touchdown, Bulldogs. Quintus Reed, the senior receiver from New Haven, Connecticut, can seemingly do no wrong along that right sideline.
Reed just doing a tremendous job reading the trajectory of that football, able to come back in and then evade the two defenders back there in Valls and Moss to find his way into the end zone.
Nikolai Lukshan to attempt the extra point. His kick is up. It is through. 48.7 seconds to play here in quarter number three. It is 21 apiece.
So we'll look at it again. And Val's, I guess, you know, overran the coverage there because the ball ended up being underthrown.
It was so terribly underthrown, it wound up being the best comeback route in the history of football, you know?
Sometimes you fail so badly, you succeed. It wraps all the way around.
Exactly.
Which are sure underflows exist.
Yeah, it's like the old Minus World in Super Mario Brothers. You know the first video game I ever played was Super Mario Brothers? I was playing that game before I could walk.
I remember Super Mario World is my first.
It's a good game. Good God, Super Mario World was your first? How much younger than me are you?
Only like 3 years.
Oh.
Yep, I can... When you play the I'm old thing, remember I'm not far behind.
That's a fair point.
Think of the Final Fantasy Mystic Quest where you can beat the final boss fairly easily if you cast your best cure spell on them several times.
Zombie boss.
Someone didn't quite nail their integers.
Yeah, no. Didn't think that one through. Luke's kickoff is another big one, booming back to about the 10-yard line, taking in there, and returns straight up the gut across the 40. Once again, a fantastic return for Keyshawn McCurdy. Fitchburg State has a weapon in the return game in big number 84.
They call him Texas. It feels like he can run the length of Texas on these kickoff returns with tremendous speed and power. Keyshawn McCurdy has had a night in the kick return game. And that's a big weapon to have. The Falcons, you know, last year, that was one of their strengths. Special teams was fairly solid for the green and gold. And just being able to build on that will help across this season.
Falcon offense back out on the field. Just 38 and a half seconds to play here in the third quarter. They have it first and 10 at their own 43. Wilson from the pistol. Takes the snap, handoff to Sims. Trips over his own lineman, but he picks up a yard. It'll be second and 9, and we'll see if Fitchburg State wants to hurry up one more play, easy for me to say, going to the right, or if they are content to switch sides. It's the first game of the season for the broadcasters, too, you know.
Yeah, we can trip over our words.
Exactly. Got
to shake off the rust a little bit.
Yes.
Falcons not required to run a play with the play clock as it is, with the game clock under 5 now.
Wilson from the pistol, he's just going to let it go. I think maybe they came up to the line and decided whether or not they wanted to run the play, decided it wasn't in their best interests to do so. But at the end of the third quarter, this is a very entertaining game. 21 apiece here from Elliott Field.
We saw 3 drives started and 3 drives concluded, all in touchdowns. Will Stafford finding the end zone on a 3-yard run to tie it. Frank Sims on that long, strange drive it was to regain the lead.
It was a long, strange drive.
And then Dean, a few good strikes, a few good plays, and Quintus Reed with a couple great receptions. He's going to be another one of those big weapons for this Dean offense. 21-21 the score. You know, Dean, they were picked to come 4th in the conference this year, but they got a first place vote in the ECFC, and really, it's a wide open conference this year. There are some pretty good teams in the ECFC. There's going to be some pretty good parity, I think. And Dean, you know, it's not the 42-7 performance they had last year, but they're making it work right now. They're staying right in, and for Fitchburg, it's great to see they're staying right in it as well. On first down, I don't know if this play is developing the way they were anticipating on. They get 2 yards out of it, or a yard, but it's just, that didn't look like it was to plan at all.
No, I don't think Wilson was the intended ball carrier there. Looked like there was some confusion at the snap with the handoff, and then Wilson just tried to make something happen. Brings up 3rd down and about 8 for the Falcons.
Feels like the most conventional plays for Fitchburg have been the ones that have not found as much success. But you can't just be running the unusual plays every time. Wilson out of the pistol, dropping back, looking left side, slings it sidearm, downfield. Is that far out there? He got pass interfered with.
Was Jonathan Ponce the intended receiver? but they're going to get Tyzon Poole for interference.
10 and 18 look a little similar sometimes.
I think it's another instance, Dan, where a ball is so underthrown that it actually benefits the offense. You see, right at the end of the play, Poole tries to come back for it.
On the defense, number 3, 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
But yeah, that's pretty clear cut right there. He's running directly into the receiver. He's got his arm outstretched across the face mask of Jonathan Ponce. That's a pretty clear cut instance of an underthrown ball leading directly to a pass interference. Winds up being a beneficial penalty for the Falcons. They'll get it at the Bulldog 40-yard line.
As we know, in college and high school football, pass interference is capped to 15 yards. So that's why it's not a spot foul. Jonathan Ponce, one of two Falcons from Virginia. Brandon Cohen, number 19, is the other one. So Aguirre in motion, making his way to the near side of the field on first and 10. Swing pass outside, right side is complete to Sahir Gomez. He's not able to get back to the line of scrimmage. Well wrapped up there by the Bulldogs.
It's a tough play for Gomez. You know, you've got a quarterback in Logan Wilson who just doesn't have the arm strength to deliver that quick out pass with any kind of zip, so it just kind of floats on him. It actually floated a little bit backward, so Gomez was running in the wrong direction when he made the catch, tried to make the adjustment, but Antonio Carrillo was right on top of him. And the freshman from Lilburn, sister city to Big Burn, Georgia, delivered the hit.
That loses 2 yards, play clock running down. Got to get this off quickly if they want to get it off at all. They get it off right at the nick of time. Wilson pumps a little bit, throws. That one is caught right near the sticks. That is Ponce who pulls that one in.
Jonathan Ponce is listed at 5'10 on the score sheet. He used all 5'10 and whatever his vertical leap is to make this catch. He jumped up, caught that on his fingertips, but he was able to get it down, get in bounds, hang on to the football, and it looks like he's picked up a first down.
He got just enough for the first down. I was not so sure about it, but yeah, they've given it. They've moved the sticks right to the 30-yard line. Knows the ball's right there on the 30. That's how close the Falcons are to retaking the lead. It's been a back and forth game. It's gonna be Sims on the carry, just runs into a wall, and that wall is named Des Diaz. Senior from Rochester stands his ground. He had 84 tackles last season, including 11 for a loss.
And he just is completely unblocked there. You see he's able to dance around the right tackle who was pulling another blocker. Bring Sims down after a loss of only a yard, or a gain rather, of only a yard. It'll be 2nd and 9 for the Falcons.
Approaching 12 minutes to go in the contest in a 21-21 game. Wilson will throw it right side. That one's caught! Marvin G. Baptiste able to haul that in at the 10-yard line.
Dan, that play looked like an absolute disaster off of the snap. Logan Wilson takes the snap, rolls to his right. You'll see here, he almost runs into Easy McKnight, and then he just lets a floaty little jump pass go. Fortunately for him, Marvin Jean Baptiste is right there. MJB says he is better than you, and you know it. It's a first down for the Falcons.
And he brings a lot of height, 6'4", 6'5", 240 pounds. One of the biggest guys on the field for the Falcons. Wilson just keeps it and goes up the middle, or Sims who gets the handoff, but either way, gets a few yards.
You can see a little bit of bad blood still. I think Frank Sims was a little bit displeased with, I believe it was Lucas Ferreira kind of swatted the ball down. Sims immediately was turning around like, flag, flag, where's the flag?
Just a quick handoff like we've seen a lot in that flexbone style. And they're going under center, so back into the flexbone essentially. Trying to slowly drive their way ever closer. gets to the 6.
Falcons are trying to go to that hard-nosed downhill running. Frank Sims is the man to do it.
Don't need a touch. Well, they can get a first down without getting the touchdown. They just have to get to the 3-yard line. So if they're still getting 3 yards at a go, it'll be worth it. And it's just going to test the Dean defense ever further.
You see a lot of extra pushing and shoving and writhing and kicking and get off me-ing after the plays here. This late, this tight a game, it's not necessarily surprising. And we get whistles that kill the play.
Timeout, Fitchburg State. Their first timeout of the half.
So calls the timeout for Fitchburg State, and they still seem to think that that first timeout was Dean's.
Okay. So that would be two timeouts aside then, correct?
I would believe. But Fitchburg calls the timeout. 10 minutes, 11 seconds to go in regulation time. It's Fitchburg State 21, Dean 21.
While we have a moment here during the timeout, we would like to thank the crew who makes this production possible here on FATV. Our director tonight is Nate Glennie, doing a fantastic job as always. Travis Falk running the audio and graphics and helping with everything related to the setup. Todd Govan, our replay operator. Camera operators are Andrew Govan, no relation, of course. Evan Schockenbach and Oliver Easton. Just a fantastic crew doing a wonderful job bringing you all the sights and sounds here from a great night for football here at Elliott Field.
Friday night under the lights, a tremendous atmosphere. Third down, it's Wilson, keeping it himself. He's going to get enough for the first down, I do believe, as he was stopped short of the end zone, but I think it's going to be good enough to refresh the downs. We'll see.
Falcons have tried that triple option a couple times tonight. It's the first time Wilson's got a real positive gain carrying it by himself.
They're going to double check to be sure.
I thought he got it.
I was thinking he got it from my sight lines, but obviously, you know, we're a little bit away.
We are a fair bit away from the ball. I have the small matter of several layers of dry wood and window trim between me and the field at the moment, so
I will stand with my prediction that they got it, and
they got it.
Our eyes did not deceive us.
Nope. There's still window trim here. My eyes are fine.
Jane Crew can take a break. Boxman put a 1 on the board.
First time rise for the Falcons.
Falcons just a few yards away from retaking the lead.
We've seen Dean have a couple nice, easy walk-in touchdowns on this end of the field. Falcons are hoping for one of their own. Give them the lead with less than 10 minutes to play.
Less than 10 feet from the end zone are Fitchburg State. They've not trailed tonight. They've led and they've been tied. It's going to be Sims making his way through. Touchdown, Falcons!
Second touchdown of the night for Frank Sims. Dan, I seem to remember somebody suggesting that it would be awfully nice for Fitchburg if they could just hand it off up the middle and have a guy walk in untouched. Does that sound familiar? Because that's kind of ringing a bell right now.
I think I remember those words. Frank Sims, 5'10", 215. Didn't have any touchdowns last year. He's got 2 tonight. And the senior captain restores the lead. Kill on for the extra point. Out of the hold from Cosner. Line drive kick. Misses to the left. Just her second career miss.
Extra point no good to the left, and that could loom large as we get toward the end of this one. But Dan, it gets back, getting back to the touchdown by Sims, and really that entire drive for Fitchburg State, particularly once they were on Dean's half of the side of the field, it all comes back to the offensive line. That's what Scott Sperone said coming into the day. He talked to you at Media Day about it. It's all about size and power and strength on the line, and you saw it there on that touchdown.
The line doing what they needed to do. And the Falcons do have the lead, but it's just 6 points, 27-21. Dakeel now 11 for 13 in her career on extra points.
And now it's up to the defense. If they can get a stop,
Falcons are going to change the kicker for this one. Han Zhao is going to kick off, the freshman from Acton.
We've seen DeKeel have a fair bit of trouble whenever they tried to kick it deep. Maybe thinking Zhao can get a little more length into this kick. Seems unlikely the Falcons would try an onsider here.
I've heard he does have some leg. We're going to see what the definition of some leg is. It was a solid kick, except for the third time, there are issues with the Falcons as they kick it off.
It's a fair point, which means that it's not quite as funny for me to make this joke, but dang it, I was committed to it. You ever see Charlotte's Web? Like the movie
game
of the book?
On the kicking team, 5-yard penalty.
That's some leg. It's the entire joke, some leg. Just imagine a spider just making a little web right across the kicking box. Or in the, you know what they'll do? A spider will make a web in the uprights, some leg.
Anyway, it was delay. They took too long.
Oh, we'll get to see some leg again.
The line drive kick making the returner's backpedal. It's Bullard who takes it in, trying to create a hard amount of velocity as he makes his way down into Fitchburg State territory.
We mentioned that we hadn't seen much of Keshawn Bullard from the running game, but he makes his presence felt as a kick returner, finally driven out of bounds by the kicker Zhao. Meanwhile, there's a Bulldog down, and this could be big.
Time
it's Quintus Reed. Quintus Reed, who has had a tremendous night as a receiver for the Bulldogs, made the last touchdown catch among many others. He is having a lot of trouble getting up. Looks like he can't put any weight right now on that left leg, but that is something to watch for the Bulldogs.
So we mentioned Reed 667 receiving yards last year. That's 2/3 of 1,000, pretty much exactly, and 6 touchdowns. Already saw him with a lot of receptions tonight. He's got 3 for 70. We'll see if we can find it here, but Bullard had to backtrack quite a distance to get to that football. And then
Reed got hit from behind.
He just saw it in the corner of the shot there.
Yeah, Quintus Reed just got hit in the back of the left leg by, you know, it wasn't a blindside block or anything. It was just, you know, football play happens. Guy gets knocked over, happens to fall into the back of Reed's leg. Good to see him walking off the field mostly under his own power. Keep an eye on him, see if he's able to get back into this one. But meanwhile, after the excellent return by Bullard, Dean has it in Falcon territory.
41 yards from goal. Cisco will hand it off on first down, out to the right side. It is Stafford, not getting very much.
Jalen Miller, the tackle for Fitchburg. Dan, is it me, but there have been a lot of possessions for both sides starting on the opposing side of the field tonight.
Does feel that way. A lot of time not spent in thy own territory. As they bring Mooney in on the near side on 2nd and 8. Stafford again with the handoff, breaking off a couple of tackles. Now the rugby maul formed. Falcons trying to push him back. Ends up getting pushed forward a little bit. It's going to be a gain of 6 yards on the right hash.
And now if you're Dean, you kind of have two goals. Obviously the first goal is to get the ball in the end zone, but the second is to just take as much time as you can. Leave the Falcons with nothing if they get the ball back.
On third down, it's Luke Noyes and Cam Manette wrapping Stafford up.
Noyes and Manette burst through into the backfield. Stafford had absolutely no chance. Manette is right there, and Noyes is more than happy to wrap him up.
Dean is 1 for 2 on fourth down tonight. They need 3 yards for a fresh set. Cisco stepping back into the shotgun. Stafford to his right, and a man in front as well. He's going to going to go. The play action throw right side. It's going to be caught by Mason, staying in bounds. He'll get the first down. And Dean continues to make their way downfield as we're halfway through this fourth quarter.
That's a tremendous play call on fourth down. It's just long enough to where you don't really feel comfortable running it, but at the same time, Fitchburg has to respect the possibility that you will. So the play action fake and then the quick flat route to the tight end, Mason. He had a step on his defender, and then everything after the catch was just gravy. It was a great play call, well executed by the Bulldogs.
Back to Stafford on first down with the option. The Topkin wrapping up along with Manette as he makes his way to the 15-yard line. Gain of about three.
That missed extra point looms oh so large right now. If the Bulldogs are able to get this in, they can take the lead with just a kick.
Seen solid consistency out of their kicker. That's faking the handoff, a throw left side to the end zone. Touchdown, Bulldogs. It's Moses Mooney who pulls it in on the jump ball on the far side, and the game is tied.
Moses Mooney and Quintus Reed have both had fantastic games for the Bulldogs. This time it's Mooney who makes the game-tying touchdown catch. Now Nikolai Lukes can give the Bulldogs their first lead of the game. I have been really impressed, Dan, with the play of Nathan Sisko coming on in relief. As the extra point is good and giving the Bulldogs the lead. Darren McDermott started for Dean, didn't do too well in his first couple of series. He was pulled and Sisko took over. And since then, Dan, this Dean offense has really come to life.
McDermott started 1 for 5, minus 2 yards and an interception. Sisko came in, he's been 9 for 10 for 175 yards and 2 touchdowns. The Falcons have had 3 different players attempt passes. Logan Wilson, 12 for 14, 149 yards and a touchdown. TJ Farr missed on his only attempt. And Elijah Zaire McKnight has attempted 2 passes, one of them finding Zaire Gomez downfield. But now Fitchburg, for the first time today, plays from behind, but there's still a good chunk of football to go.
Still plenty of time on the clock, plenty of time for Fitchburg State to run their offense.
Very interesting second half.
Falcons only have 10 players on the field right now. There we go. There's the 11th guy running on at the last minute.
And they're going to just let that go out of bounds because they really didn't want it to go to McCurdy again.
That was a strategic kickoff out of bounds. Yeah. Given the explosiveness that we've seen from McCurdy, that's it's a defensible choice, honestly.
So now the options go to Coach Sperone. I believe it's going to be 5 yards from where it goes out, because I don't think it went 30 yards.
It really didn't. Lukes didn't even make it look like he was trying to kick that downfield. He just booted the dang thing on a diagonal.
Wanted to kick it as far away from Keyshawn McCurdy as possible, and, well, he succeeded in doing that.
He's kind of wind up giving the Falcons the ball at, like, the 45-yard line, though.
Is that really a positive? Don't want to take
any bounds on the kicking team. Ball went out of bounds at the 35-yard line. The ball replaced 5 yards from there at the 40-yard line. First down.
Okay, so they avoid kicking it deep because there's a fair chance that McCurdy will take it to the house or whatever, but instead they just hand the Falcons the ball at the 40-yard line with 6.5 minutes and 2 timeouts and say, go, have fun.
Coach Marone is at the numbers asking for clarification. But for why?
That's a wonderful question. There's three striped shirts and a man in a green polo.
The gentleman in the green polo just wants clarification on whatever happened there.
He seems satisfied with the explanation once he finally got it. So he may be harboring ill thoughts, I don't know. Does not look like a happy man right now.
Falcons are playing from behind for the first time today. Guerre moves to the far side. It's going to be a quick throw out there to Dylan Cosner, who gets wrapped up and then a flag at the very end, I believe.
Keen Weeks delivered the hit.
Cosner from Endicott, New York, was a quarterback on the roster last year, converted to receiver.
There was indeed a flag thrown, but now the officials are conferring.
Wonder if maybe a hand was a little too high on the tackle.
It's possible.
Personal foul, face mask on the defense. 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
That would seem to be the indication, Dan, and that is a huge break for the Falcons. Turns a negative play setting up second down and 13 into a first down in Bulldog territory. Let's take a look at it again.
Out there, and I think the right hand there is closed on the face mask.
Yeah, it was kind of away from our view. It was toward the far sideline. But you could sort of see Weeks with his right arm up around the face mask. It's a big break for the Falcons. First to 10 now at the Bulldog 45.
Dean has given away a lot of yards through penalties. That's tipped up in the air and incomplete. Wilson nearly caught it. He's trying to throw to the near side, and someone got a hand up there.
Pass was batted at the line of scrimmage. I think it was Zion Edison who made the deflection.
I haven't even tried to look at the penalty yardage tonight. It's 92 for Dean and 68 for Fitchburg.
That's a lot.
Also, okay, that's not right. I was going to say Fitchburg has time of possession of, right now Live Stats is trying to tell me that there's been 65 minutes of possession in this game.
That doesn't sound right. It seems incorrect.
Yeah, sometimes programs go awry. Second down, Wilson, a little bit of time, rolling to his left, gets a throw off, finds Easy McKnight. At the 39-yard line, turns what could have been a big loss into a gain of six.
I'm a little surprised, Dan, at just how much Fitchburg State has gone to the air here. Still had, or had at the start of this drive, more than 6 minutes. According to the officials, they have two timeouts. The scoreboard shows one for them, but I believe the last time Fitchburg took one, the referee said that it was their first. Mm-hmm. So I think, according to the Zebras on the field, Fitchburg, or rather both sides, have two. Regardless, it is now third and four for Fitchburg, obvious four down territory for them. I've got to think they go on the ground here, don't you?
Well, they've got three to the left. Wilson is going to use those three as blockers to get a first down. Or get very close to the stick. Take your pick.
Dan, you mentioned that Dean may have been stacking the box, trying to stop that conventional running game for Fitchburg. It's an unconventional run here. I really don't think Wilson ever intended to throw this ball. He may have looked downfield, but he was carrying it all the way. He does get a first down.
I think he was willing to entertain the motion if something opened downfield, but it was mainly going to be a run. And the conventional running has not been... It's like he'll get 3 yards out of it. But we're getting pretty deep into the game for 3 yard runs down and down and down. Wilson rolls right side on first down, throws incomplete, just a little overthrown for Zaire McKnight. And I've been mentioning, you know, sometimes, you know, the throws when he's missed his target have looked a little off, but you don't really think to realize he's only missed on four passes tonight.
No, it has been a pretty accurate night for Wilson. The one thing, you know, you could point to as a criticism is, aside from that big, deep ball, there haven't been too many large chunks of distance. You know, it's been little dump-off passes or screens, that sort of thing. But, you know, Falcons are making it work. Again, you know, the last time they put 27 points on the board in a game was back at Worcester State, and the defense did most of that scoring. So it's hard to fault the offense too much.
Second down, 10 to go. Wilson, left side, wanted to throw. Couldn't get the time to get the ball off. And he's wrapped up. Joe Penton with the sack.
Wilson ducked out a one hit only to be bowled over by the other. Great coverage downfield by the Bulldogs. You'll see here he rolls out to his left. He's under pressure. He sees the pressure in front of him coming from Dez Diaz, but he doesn't see Joe Penton until it's too late. Big loss makes it third down and 13. Falcons have got to find a way on these next two plays to get 13 yards.
Two receivers to the right, and Wilson looking for time. Just looking for time, lobs it up and just tries to throw it away at that point. He did not find the time, and Noah Pearson a bit slow to get up for Dean.
Dean's sideline is looking for intentional grounding. And I think Wilson was sufficiently out of the pocket. And now, well, I'm just gonna state some facts for a second. It is fourth and 13. The punting unit is on the field. Fitchburg State was 6 out of 9 on fake punts last season. I have stated facts.
The line of scrimmage is the Dean 39-yard line.
I know it's fourth and 13. I feel like this one ranks pretty high on the old surrender index.
Ball start, offense, number 80. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
Even if it wasn't a false start, the play clock could also run out.
Hey, Brent, you're not
now, if anything, I think that's giving him more yardage in case of a touchback.
The surrender index will look a little more favorably now, but it's still a bit high. The Falcons are going to need to trust their defense.
You needed a stop either way. That is true. Weird things can happen.
Barr is going to throw it downfield. It's caught by somebody. It's caught by nobody.
No, it's caught by somebody. It's caught by Keem Weeks.
Keem Weeks.
Keem Weeks just did a very dumb thing, to be perfectly honest with you, Dan.
And so PJ Farr with the 40-yard arm punt.
Exactly. It's like, you know, in the stat sheet, and if you care about quarterback rating and that sort of thing, okay, he threw an interception. That's bad. That's not good. It's much better than if he threw an incomplete pass. Let's be honest with ourselves.
The Falcons will take the interception on the jump ball. Jalen Miller, I think, was the one downfield trying to get that one, and Marvin Jean Baptiste there as well. Yeah, that was a tremendous arm punt.
It really was. It's first and 10 at the 6. You'll take that.
The happiest you're ever going to see a team after throwing an interception. Stafford gets 3 yards on first down.
Like, if you told the Falcons, okay, there are 3 possible outcomes here. It is first and 10 for you at their 6. That's the best one. It is first and 10 for them at their 40. That's the worst one. It is first and 10 for them at their 6. That's pretty okay.
Now, the question is, I know we said 6 for 9 on fake punts last year. Does that go in the books as a failure or a success?
That is a failure.
It's a failure, but it was a successful outcome. So second down, 7 to go, watching the play clock, down to 3 seconds. Stafford up the middle, continuing to churn his feet. He's gotten to the 15.
Timeout, Fitchburg State. Their second charge timeout of the half.
Fitchburg State calls what the officials will say is the second time out.
So now it is really incumbent upon the defense. If Dean gets a first down here, they can pretty much run it out.
We've seen tonight from the D-line when Dean has run the football, basically the whole gamut of outcomes. Either a successful stop or a unsuccessful stop by the defense leading to 10
plus
yards.
Please reset the game clock to 2:50. 2:50.
Officials are going to put 5 extra seconds back on the game clock. beneficial for the Falcons. Extra 5 seconds, but of course the main thing here is their defense needs to get a stop.
Third and short for Dean. Be a huge first down if they can get it. Stafford wrapped up in the backfield. That's the stop they needed, a loss of two.
An absolutely
timeout, Fitchburg State. Their third and final timeout of the half.
As it turned out, Fitchburg did in fact that first timeout where they signaled Fitchburg and said Dean. Dean really did take that timeout. So we now know Fitchburg has exhausted their timeouts.
An incredible defensive stop for the Falcons, giving the offense one more chance. Dan, if it comes down to a field goal, does Han Xiao have the leg?
Oh, issue here! Big issue! What's gonna happen here? Lots of things happening. Ball is loose. Falcons have it in their hands. Somebody tell me what just happened. I have no idea. Jan Fowles is the happiest man of all on the field.
Jan Fowles' expression tells the entire story. He has no idea what just happened, but he is very sure that it's good.
We've been referencing last season a few times. Last season, Monty Tech played Worcester Tech here on FATV, and Jan Fowles had two interceptions for Worcester Tech, including one that killed a drive when Monty Tech was so deep into Worcester Tech territory, and one that event essentially sealed the game at the end. And I even told him, you know, you had two picks last time you were on FATV. You gonna do some good things for the Falcons again? It was a bad snap.
During the play, yeah, Huntington threw the ball backwards, which is a backwards pass, but the ball's still alive. Recovered by the defense in the end zone, touchdown.
The officials on field have confirmed that it was a touchdown. The punter never controlled the snap. They ruled that the Bears threw it backwards. I think you see right here, it's picked up and then trying to avoid a safety. He's trying to avoid a safety. He chucks it in the air. They ruled that a backwards pass. It is then picked up on the fly by Vowles for a touchdown. Incredible.
If anyone is capturing how I called that touchdown, just write incoherent
after the touchdown.
Yep.
On sportsmanlike conduct, on the scoring team, number 25. That penalty forced on the kickoff 15 yards. Do the try on the 3-yard line.
Han Xiao was on the sideline shrugging like, what did I do? They had to get it on Fowles.
Yeah.
What did Han Xiao do?
I don't know.
I think Han Xiao is saying, what did I do? He's getting his coach talking to him. Maybe he did something.
I don't know.
I have no idea.
So, Pittsburgh's got to go for two with the missed extra points.
Yeah, listen, there's still a football game to play here. There's 5-point lead, 2.5 minutes to play.
Falcons going to try to make it 35-28. Pitch out to Zaire McKnight. He's going to throw. Looking for Wilson, overthrown. Had him open, though. The situation remains the same. They've got to prevent Dean from getting a touchdown, the Falcons do. But through that turn of events, Fitchburg has the lead.
Incredible. That's the kind of play that winds up on SportsCenter.
All of this happening.
I don't think any Bulldog player ever fully possessed the ball on that entire exchange. I think Joe Penton was the closest, and then he lost it, and it just bounced up somehow, miraculously, into the arms of Jan Valls.
So 2 minutes 39 seconds remain in this contest. It's Fitchburg State 33, Dean 28. The Bulldogs have two timeouts. The Falcons don't have any. I don't know how much they care about that at the moment.
I think they'll take the situation the way it is. You know what, Dan? Again, arm punt. If that play, that exact play, happens at like the 40-yard line, the Falcons take over at their 20-yard, which is bad for Dean. But still, I have no idea. And now, if you're the Falcon defense, you just got what you thought was the stop you needed. And then you had that incredible euphoric moment, and now you have to focus again.
And remember, they're kicking off from their own 20 because of the unsportsmanlike conduct. They'll be taken in by one of the up men. He's trying to dance his way past midfield. Fitchburg's going to try to strip the ball from him as he gets across the 50-yard line. Cam Fong was the return man. He gets it into Fitchburg territory, but now the test is clear. 2 minutes, 29 seconds left. Dean trails by 5, and they need a touchdown.
But again, Dan, for this Falcon defense, you just got the stop. You thought you had the stop, and then something amazing happened. And now you need the stop again, this time to win it.
Let's go back to that Worcester State game. The Falcons trying to protect a lead late and weren't able to do it. Sisko, lots of time, slings it down. Left side tipped up in the air and incomplete. Nearly picked off by Jalen Miller. Cameron Tompkin in the area, and it's good to see that Quintus Reed is all right.
Good to see Quintus Reed back on the game. How many times today, Dan, have we seen underthrown deep balls work out well for the offense? That was an underthrown deep ball that was nearly a killer for the Dean offense. They go deep, it's underthrown. Miller is right there, and it just bounces off his hands.
Second down, Sisko looking to run again. And he throws left side. It's going to be complete to Mason. And he's going to fight his way out of bounds, although behind the stick.
I think they're going to give him forward progress to the 36-yard line and a first down.
Sounds about right.
34, excuse me. Clock continues to run as we duck under 2 minutes to play here.
Bullard was open on the left side on the numbers with his hands up like, why are you throwing it to me? But they found something better downfield. Sisko has done very well in his first action in quite some time. Stepping into the game after McDermott had struggles, Sisko has done very well. The junior throws over the middle. It is complete to Mooney. Clock will keep running as it ticks to 90 seconds.
Bulldogs are moving quickly, but they're not hurrying. They know they have time. They know they have timeouts. They can run their offense.
Second down, throw right side. That's going to be caught. Mooney cutting inside. Now going to be pushed out of bounds. We'll stop the clock with 72 seconds left. It's enough for another first down for Dean.
Falcon defense has been playing off a little bit, trying not to get beat deep. There is plenty of time. Bulldogs don't have that far to go.
20 yards from goal is Dean. Hand off, Bullard, left side. He's got a lot of opening to work with, and he gets nearly 15 yards.
Falcons are playing four guys in the box, two deep safeties, and everybody's 5 yards off their man. Of course Dean's gonna run. There's plenty of blocking there. There's plenty of open yardage. There is no second level, basically.
Timeout on the field.
It's just completely unblocked running until he's inside the five.
Timeout on the field with 64 seconds left. Dean is inside the Falcon 10-yard line.
Logan Perez was injured on that play, needed a little bit of help getting off the field. That explains the timeout on the field. A free clock stoppage for Dean. They still have two timeouts as we go under a minute to play.
The drama ratcheted up here at Elliott Field. Mason in motion, doesn't know where to go. Finally finds somewhere to go as Cisco is going to try to run it. Inside the five, he's knocked down. Clock will keep running under 40 seconds.
Calvin Guillaume made the tackle. And the Bulldogs will take timeout.
Please reset the game clock to 40 seconds. 40 seconds.
So the Bulldogs take their second timeout with 40 seconds left to play here in the fourth quarter. Touchdown for them pretty much seals the win.
We would say that, but with
stranger
this game,
things have happened. That's true. Fair point. This has been an incredible game here at Elliott Field. We said at the top that the Falcons have nowhere to go but up. From a certain perspective, no matter what happens, this game is a positive. Good things are on the horizon for Fitchburg State. That having been said, you have a 5-point lead with 40 seconds left. You'd like to win the game, so if you're a Fitchburg fan, and I am a Fitchburg State alum that's currently wearing a green shirt, let's go win the game, please.
Here it comes. A lot of things going wrong again! Oh my goodness! Dean outthought themselves! And the long, long losing streak's gonna come to an end! Nicholas Polanco's got the ball! The Falcons are a kneel down or two away from winning this game.
I never thought I would see a weirder, worse play call than let's not hand the ball to Marshawn Lynch, right? In this situation, let's run a double reverse direct snap for the first trick play we've tried in the entire game is a worse play call than let's not hand the ball to Marshawn Lynch.
I just cannot believe that was what they tried to do. They outthought themselves. They tried to pull the trick play instead of just giving it to Will Stafford, which has worked out so well tonight. And as the final seconds tick off here at Elliott Field, for the first time since November 1st, 2019, the Falcons are victorious!
Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable.
To think, what happened on that punt? What Dean wanted to punt it. It was a bad snap.
Go back before that, the fake punt.
The fake punt that turned into an arm punt that pinned Dean at the 6-yard line. That is the greatest interception of all time.
It's the greatest interception that's ever been thrown. Yeah. TJ Farr has thrown the greatest interception in the history of football. Aside, you remember Tom Brady in the San Diego playoff game, the one that Troy Brown stripped? T.J. Farr threw the second greatest interception of all time. But still.
Look at this again, just because I can't even believe this is what Dean decided to do. The direct snap to Bullard.
They're running the Philly special, is what they're trying to do.
And they fail.
That's the Philly special. That's exactly what the Eagles did in the Super Bowl against the Patriots. The quarterback moves up to the line, motions out to the right, direct snap to the running back, pitches it to the receiver, receiver throws to the quarterback for a wide open touchdown. They wanted to run the Philly special instead of just handing it off up the middle.
So what I'm coming away with is this. The bad snap, you know, that's the bad snap that leads to the Falcons' winning score. That was, you know, them making a mistake in whatever, their errors. This play call was self-inflicted. They decided they wanted to try the Philly special to win. And they did this and have failed in the most spectacular of manners, and Fitchburg State find themselves in the win column. Scottsboro's got his first career victory, but who would have thought it would have come like this in a game we've been waiting so long to call Falcon football again, and it's just hard to come up with words to describe what this game was. It was unlike any other game I think I've ever seen.
When Dean thinks back again at the end of this game, they are going to think we blew it. And to a certain respect, they're right. Take a look again at what turned out to be the game-winning touchdown. It was fourth down. They were punting. The only reason they were pinned this far back in their own territory to begin with is because they made the mental error of not knocking it down. How many times have we said it here on FATV? Defensive coaches every time should be reminding their players, it's fourth down. Knock it down. The interception, an unforced error that pins the Bulldogs back in their own territory. The muffed punt, an unforced error that gives the Falcons the lead. The blown Philly special, an unforced error that costs the Bulldogs the chance to win the game. Dean absolutely is correct in feeling that they blew this game. At the same time, Fitchburg State deserved this win. Fitchburg State played so well. This is a I don't want to say everything is hunky-dory. I don't want to say everything is, you know, sunshine and rainbows and puppies and happiness for the Fitchburg Falcons program, and in 4 years they're going to be beating Miami to win the national championship or anything. That is not going to happen. They're probably going to lose a football game or two this season. But dang it, Dan, this football team is transformed. This is a completely different team from the team that we saw last year.
So much more excitement, so much more optimism. I've noticed they've not assigned that number one jersey. I can see Scott Sperone holding it up in the air. The team's motto, we won, we won, we won. Tonight they have won. And all the hard work they put in the offseason has paid off. They're back in the win column for the first time in quite a long time. And it's, again, very difficult to come up with words in this contest. The Falcons are 1-0. And next week, they're going to go up to Castleton. They're going to try to make it 2-0. But tonight, you know, it's been... What I find really interesting, too, is the first five drives in the second half ended in scores. The last three drives ended in turnovers. And not only that, I'm also thinking to the catastrophe on the punt. If Dean had actually just taken the safety, they would have had a very good opportunity for a field goal.
They would have.
Fitchburg would have had the ball, too, but after that. But
unbelievable.
It's like it may have been better to just take the safety in that situation, but my goodness. I mean, you can second-guess yourself for a while, but this was, you know,
A heck of a football game.
Yeah, it's been, you know, 9.5 months since the last time we covered a football game, because that's how football seasons work.
That's true.
But... And the last one was not one that I'd like to particularly remember.
One was better than that one.
This one is one I think I would like to particularly remember.
I would rather call this game than that game if I had a choice. Mm-hmm. Do we get that choice? Do I get to choose? Because I'll choose this game over that game every single time. Oh, my goodness, folks. Thank you so much for being part of this broadcast here on FATV. We want to let you know our next telecast of Fitchburg football will be this coming Thursday, September the 8th, from historic Crocker Field as the Red Raiders of Fitchburg host Leominster. The Thanksgiving rematch. Then the next night, Friday the 9th, it'll be Montech and Murdoch, both of those games here on FATV. Before we get out of here, we want to thank a couple of folks. First of all, our fantastic crew, our director, Nate Glennie, audio and graphics run by Travis Falk, Todd Govan on replay, Andrew Govan, Evan Schockenbach, and Oliver Easton on camera. Dan, why don't we thank our underwriters before we say goodbye?
Indeed, our underwriters will make our remote productions possible. Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance, Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise.
Thank you once again to them for their support. And if you would like to support FATV, absolutely go on to FATV.org. You will find all the information you need right there. I have no words to possibly sum it up, and therefore I will do what I do best, and that is pass the buck to Dan Bolak. Dan, your final thoughts from an incredible opening night here at Elliott Field.
There were tremendous plays in this contest. There were also tremendous errors in this contest. We saw so many penalties. We saw a point where the game devolved into a battle of indiscipline. We saw a mistake that turned out to be the winning move in the grand scheme of things. And the type of thing that might get you one, maybe two question marks in the chess notation. Shout out Chess Chat.
Uh-huh.
But it turned into, well, that wasn't checkmate, but it turned into a tremendous counter. And Dean, you know, Dean played very well. They're going to be competitive in the ECFC this year. I liked what I saw out of Nathan Sisko. The Falcons, you know, they found some success. They got lucky at times thanks to Dean's indiscipline, but they had some great plays. They bring the power of unpredictability, which is something huge to have because it makes the opponent second-guess all of their actions. And at the end of the day, why the heck would you run the Philly special in that spot instead of just giving it to the guy who's been so good?
That's a good question. At the same time, you know what? If the Eagles had effed up the Philly special, we would be asking why the Eagles ran the Philly special.
We would. And really,
oh, my goodness.
Well, Dean will have time to think about this, but for the Falcons, they will soak it in and then turn their attention to the Spartans of Castleton, who will be taking on Plymouth State tomorrow in another MASCAC ECFC matchup. And we'll be looking forward to when we come back here in 2 weeks to open up conference play with Fitchburg State taking on the Lancers of Worcester State.
It has been a tremendous opening night here at Elliott Field. What a wonderful way, by the way, to christen this new playing surface here at Elliott Field.
The first victory for a Falcon team on this brand new playing surface, and it's a night that Falcon fans who are here or watching here tonight will never forget.
Special thanks, of course, to everyone here at Fitchburg State University who makes it possible. And thank you all for watching. For Dan Bolak and the entire FATV crew, I'm John Gugarty saying thank you so much for being with us. We will see you next time right here on FATV.